Flat Earth Debate Uncut and After Show. I'm your host, Nathan Oakley, and if you are new to this channel, or you've not done so already, then be sure to subscribe. Hit the bell notification icon and join button if you'd like to become a Nathan Oakley 1980 channel member and keep up to date with the Flat Earth Debate. If you would like to support the channel, there is a super chat that runs alongside each of these shows while they premiere, and there's also a Ko-Fi, Patreon, Crypto, and Thanks button in the info box below the video. Speaking of Patreons, I'm going to do a quick shout out to all of you who do support me on Patreon. So, a very massive and enormous shout out to Hannah Bear, Gary Hughes, Measured Flat, Chris Wouters, Mr. Amish, Sensual Goat, Mitch Kennedy, Rod, The Name's Burley, Todd Wazzle, Jason Hornsby, Flat Earth Travolta, JMails24, Unamento, M, Iron26, Endless, Golden McKinnon, Retro Bill, Level Plain Poem, Michael Kahn, John Kays, Patrick Gunnels, Banter, Mel B. Styles, Hairy Blade, Mobile Mac 777, Rob W., Del West Watson, Unbelievable Productions, Blue Ridge Ranger, Abraham Mohammed, Skeptic 936, Life is Short, Texas Mike, David Wayne Foster, and Dank. So another massive thank you to all of you for supporting me on Patreon. If you did want to become a patron, links in the info box, as I say. With that, I'll hand over to whoever is in Politics Discord server and G+, so you can enjoy their dulcet tones while I set up for today's live show.
Yeah, well, it was more of a... Like if you can see them faking it once, then it just opens up like, well, why? Why fake it even once? What's the point? Like, iPhones exist, right? So if they're up in space, they've got iPhones, there should be unlimited 4K, 60 FPS footage from up in space. There's no need to fake it even once. And when you see videos that were put out by through official NASA distribution that show astronauts turning literally see-through and becoming transparent in real time as they start walking around a corner, then you're like, well, hold on a minute. Or people go to grab items that are there for them in augmented reality, but they're not actually there because they've kind of got it a bit wrong and they've just grabbed the completely wrong place. It just opens it up to interesting. Why? Like, why? What's the point? Why not just film themselves in space? Why go through the effort of faking it?
I don't quite get it. Are you saying that? Are you saying that there is like a footage that would show it?
Yeah, loads. Mm-hmm. So somebody's just posted an hour of examples where the technology's gone wrong. It's glitching. There's harnesses. You know, if you don't want to watch the full hour, watch 10 minutes. Watch 5. Watch 2.
I've watched 2. I'm not quite sure what I'm looking at here.
I've not seen that particular video. Maybe the first 2 minutes of that particular video aren't great. But if it's something you're interested in, I can, you know, I'll send you a few examples where I've watched the video myself and thought, well, okay, this needs some explaining, doesn't it?
But yeah.
What I would say is, just because you see one of those, I didn't then think, oh, because I've seen one, that means they're all fake. That wasn't where I got to when I first started looking. But it did create enough of a curiosity in my mind where I'm like, well, why fake it even once?
Hey, you seem to be talking about like fake astronaut footage, and I'm asking you to give me that. Or like, are you saying all of it is fake?
No, that's not what I'm saying. Because that would be a leap, right? I'm just talking about what led me to first get like super curious, and that was a big one. Seeing, because if you find one, like say for example, if we use like the Narnia, you know, no, that's a bad one. If I say to you, like, I was on holiday in France, and you're like, oh yeah, cool. Then you look through my photo album, and in that photo album, there's one picture where you can see clear and obvious signs of fakery. You wouldn't then think, oh, I guess all the photos of France are fake. But it would create enough of a seed of doubt in your mind to be like, well, why show me that one fake image of his fake holiday? I don't get it. Does that make sense? That was where I was with it in my head when I first, you know, saw that kind of thing. It didn't make me think it's all fake, but it did get me thinking, well, like, why fake it even once? What's the point?
Well, are you saying you saw fake footage? Or I don't, like, and which one would be the fake footage? Are you saying that, like, those aren't real Austin? I kind of don't get what you're saying.
So I found a video here. Go to 3 minutes. This is just an example. Go to 3 minutes, and let me find the exact timestamp for you.
Well, I hate streaming sites. I hate Amazon. Yeah. I hate Rumble.
It's not 3 minutes. It's more 3 minutes.
I like Odyssey, 20. Though.
Go to 3 minutes 20, and then you see a little spaceman. As he's about to go around the corner, he becomes invisible.
3 minutes.
3 minutes 20.
3 minutes 20.
It starts at exactly 3 minutes 25, but do 3 minutes 20. I'm just getting a parcel.
So I've got this guy in a black shirt, right? And he's kind of lagging. And then they're repeating him raising up the microphone. And then it changes to another guy, I think, in socks, blue trousers. It's 3 minutes 27.
Yeah, blue trousers, socks.
Yeah. And he fades out, yeah.
So that right there isn't, there it is, pack it up, boys, Earth flat. But there's 50, there's something like 500 different things I've seen like that.
Okay.
Of a comparable quality, let's call it. And when I see things like that, I think, well, okay, there is evidence there of, call it, manipulation. If we don't want to use the word fake, it can be quite emotionally charged, right? Oh, let's use, at a minimum, manipulation.
What do you mean by examples. Manipulation? Like, that someone, like, inserted the guy and...
Well, no. Why? We know people don't turn transparent when they're walking around corners, right? They don't.
No.
Yeah. Okay. So what's going on there? I don't know the answer to that question. Well, exactly. I don't know either.
Okay.
But that got me curious. Because there's evidence there, like, people don't just turn transparent, so something else is going on.
Uh-huh.
And when you watch 500-plus different examples of glitches, of people turning transparent, of people clearly getting caught on harnesses when they're, quote-unquote, in zero-G, and you just start thinking, well, what's going on here? Like, what is this? What's the deal?
I don't know. I don't quite understand. Are you saying that, like, because, like, the footage looks weird, like, it, like, someone made it look weird, like, intentionally, or like it's like?
I think what he's saying is that there's issues with the footage, and whether it's been altered or doctored. We don't know, but there's definitely issues with the footage.
Yeah, I mean, I do see footage that looks like it's not directly capturing what's going on in real life. Yeah, I agree with that.
So how
do we don't even need to go that far. Yeah, we don't need to look at space. We can just have a look at what we have right here on the Earth, what's under our feet, and we don't even have to consider space. Being that it's a violation of natural law. Whatever they're doing, they're not doing it in the place that they're telling us they're doing it from.
What makes you think so?
Well, due to the fact that space would be a violation of natural laws as we know it. So it would be a violation of gas laws, gas pressure in particular.
Explain.
It would also be a violation of entropy laws, being entropy of gases, and
brother,
entropy of gases.
AJ, you're telling me things. Awesome.
I'm going to explain to you, dude. Just let me finish, yeah. So, antecedent to gas pressure, according to gas laws, is a container. So we're looking at PSI, pounds per square inch, of particles pressing upon the walls of that container. So are you able to demonstrate for me gas pressure without a container?
I don't quite understand what you're saying.
Okay, so I'll give you a very simple example. Your car tire, yeah? Your car tire acts as a container so that you can put pressure into the tire. If you do not have the tire, the containment, then you cannot obtain pressure in that tire.
What? If I don't have a tire, I don't have an entire a tire to inflate. Is that what you're saying?
If let's just say you have a hole in that tire, yeah? And you try to inflate it, are you going to be able to obtain pressure without the gas being contained if you have a hole in that tire, or is it going to leak out?
I mean, like, if, probably not, right? Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So the antecedent to gas pressure is a container. To obtain pressure, we need gas to fill the available space and then press upon the walls of the container so that we can obtain gas pressure. Huh? Does that make sense?
Sure.
Okay, so are we able to demonstrate pressure without a container?
Like what you mean, like gas pressure?
Yeah, can we obtain gas pressure without containment?
Yeah, probably.
How would we do that?
Like with something with a hole in it, is what you're saying?
No. I think you're misunderstanding, yeah?
Okay.
Pressure. To obtain pressure, we require a container, just like to obtain pressure on your car tire, you require mm-hmm. the tire to contain those gases. So are we able to, on the Earth, the claim of the globe is that we have a pressurized system next to a near-perfect vacuum without containment. So are we able to demonstrate this in reality?
I don't understand what you're trying to say. But it's all right, man. Like, I was talking to the Felix guy.
No, that's cool. But you're talking about Narnia. Yeah, you're talking about something where no one can go due to it breaking natural laws. So, you know, we're having a discussion about whether these films have been altered or doctored or what's occurring there. We don't even have to go down that path, yeah? We don't have to go to space. One,
what the fuck? What the fuck is not what the fuck? Like, why are you being like really mean?
Excuse me. For no reason. Please not swear.
I don't think I'm being very mean. Yeah.
Please can you not swear?
I don't know. He called me dumb.
No, I didn't call you dumb. No one called you dumb.
Someone added me with a GIF saying, no. "You play dumb very convincingly," right?
I think what people forget. Oh,
well, don't worry about what they're writing there. Yeah, we're having a discussion.
Yeah, people forget how difficult it is to bridge the gap between brand new to the topic where you guys are right now. And when you're brand new to the topic, the idea that space is completely made up and not real, and there's no such thing, that for me took a long time to get my head around. It's so deeply ingrained that when you first start attacking or trying to deconstruct the idea of space, you first start trying to walk people down the path of they are faking space. It's difficult. And I think a lot of the issues I see are people who've been in the kind of topic for a while, and they maybe forget how difficult the first steps are. The first moments of thinking, hey, maybe I've been lied to here.
Yeah. I understand what you're trying to say there, but I would disagree with you, yeah? Especially, well, personally for myself, Someone bringing to me a video of astronauts maybe disappearing a bit out of frame, a few issues with the video, you know, as a glober, that probably wouldn't make me think too much. But if I was presented with something such as natural gas laws or entropy laws, and that can be demonstrated that it can't be replicated as claimed, that's something that would actually make me think. Otherwise, again, we're not discussing any real facts, yeah? We're just discussing opinions and, you know, where it could, what it could be.
Are all of you physicists? Facts, yeah?
What can be shown or what can be proven?
Like, I've got to disclose it to you. I don't really have any idea of physics. Like maybe Felix said that he was a physicist, and like, if you're a physicist as well, like, maybe...
I didn't say I was a physicist. I said I studied physics.
I'm sorry. But it, like, doesn't matter, right, to me now.
Yeah, I understand what you mean.
But, like, if you... Like, maybe these things mean things to you. If you're telling me about gas laws, like, this is, like, some vague shit I heard in chemistry class in high school.
Sorry to interrupt, Anthony.
Yeah, what's up?
Markley, can I just ask a couple of things of you, if you don't mind? Number one, please can you try what's not up? To swear? The second thing is, if you're not talking, please can you go on mute? I appreciate you're keen to put your two penny within when someone else is talking to you, but if you can, just pop yourself on mute until they're done talking. It just causes a bit of audio chaos. Thanks.
Gotcha.
Okay, so you were asking for an explanation, and that's what I was trying to do. So I'll let you know, and I can maybe drop some information for you in the chat that gas laws state that the requirement for gas pressure is a container to contain those gases, because the gas particles are going to press upon the walls of that container. Okay, so the globe claims to have gas pressure next to a near-perfect vacuum without this container, which is violating those gas laws. So we would need to see, in reality, gas pressure obtained, without a container.
Are you sure about that?
Does that make sense for you?
Oh. Are you saying that there can't be, like, temperature differentials without walls between gases?
100% there can be temperature differentials, so then you'd be discussing
pressure
gradient, yeah?
Yeah.
So temperature affects the pressure, and we'd have a temperature or a pressure, gradient. Again, we first require the pressure to first have a pressure gradient in the first place, still requiring the containment to obtain the gradient. And yes, we live in a dynamic system, and that was my second point, which would be entropy of gases, one of the most widely cited irreversible changes of gases. So entropy states that high pressure is going to fill low pressure. So if we go back to our car tire and we put a hole in it, your car tire is going to be at 30 psi. The outside atmo is going to be at about 14 psi. So your car tire is going to deflate until the pressure inside and outside that tire equalizes. It's going to fill the available space. So we live in a dynamic place where we've got temperature variances, which create winds, which create pressure variances, et cetera. But what you'll find when we, even in our weather, when we have a high pressure or a low pressure system, eventually the high pressure will always find that low pressure and they will cancel each other out. We still require that containment.
Bro, I'm sorry, but it's really difficult for me what you're, like, you're trying to, like, reason with this, that space doesn't exist. Like, are you saying that, like, what does that even mean? Like, what, I'm sorry, I don't understand.
Yes.
Well, it means that space, as we explained, is a violation of natural laws. And we can't demonstrate what's explained to occur.
Do you mean by space there being a vacuum above our heads, basically?
Beside a pressurized system without containment. That is impossible, my friend.
Yes, vacuum of outer space does not exist in reality, is what he's saying.
All right.
Is that clear enough? Okay. It cannot possibly exist. You are breathing pressurized air here on Earth.
Uh-huh.
Do you know what vacuum
is?
Neil, just relax.
The vacuum is like when there's no air, right?
There you go. So how can you live in a pressurized system and simultaneously believe that you exist in a vacuum?
I thought it's just like a lot of gas stacked up on top of each other. And that
way, what is containing that gas? What is containing that gas against the vacuum?
What do you mean?
He's claiming other gases. So no, gases do not contain gases. Yeah, we'd need a demonstration of gases containing gases if we're going to head down that path.
What? So you're saying that, like, gases can't sink down?
No, the gases can't contain gases. We require a container, not a gas gradient, where the gases above are pressing down upon the gases below to contain those gases.
Why? I don't quite get.
What? Because
are you saying? Are you saying
the definition of gas pressure
is
the force exerted by the gas molecules on the walls of its container.
Mm-hmm. And why does the and the walls have to be solid, right?
Say that again.
And the walls have to be solid.
Containment must exist. You cannot be in vacuum.
Yeah. Like, otherwise, they have to be like solid walls. Can the walls be liquid?
Yeah, you see that in like a bubble, like if you scuba dive and you exhale, the bubble goes up and it's being contained by like water.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, there's lots of different demonstrations. Some people say that it could do with, you know, magnets or whatever. Yeah, there's got to be some kind of container.
Okay, sorry, just to round this out.
I don't quite get I don't quite see the contradiction between like a vacuum.
Hold on, Crit. Which bit don't you understand? So I can just round it out for you because you've been told in many different ways.
All right, so like AJ, like maybe it's just like the way AJ explained it, but like AJ said, bro, space is impossible, and by space he means there being like a vacuum far up ahead, okay, and he's saying that this can't be true because the other guy said, well, we're breathing pressurized air, and it is basically impossible for there to be pressurized air outside of something like a car tire or whatever.
Have you been following the
hold on a second, Crit. Just one sec.
Visual explanation.
Hold on. Everyone can just mush and Crit and everyone else. Just one sec. I didn't hear a question in there. What you said you were confused about something. You didn't ask any questions.
So
you just stated.
I don't quite see. So one, I'm not sure if they can't, like, aren't we? Okay. So. Yeah, I'm just not sure why it's impossible for there to be like air that's pressurized outside of something like a car tire or something.
Okay.
Something with solid walls
Fine.
Or something.
Okay, I got your question. It's a violation of the second law of thermodynamics, entropy law, gas fills space. If there's a volume available to gas, it will fill it. Gas expands at a high rate of speed into whatever volume it is available to it. So if the sky above our head was an available volume, as it is claimed to be, if you think you're living on a sphere, you're not. But if you think you are, there's a rhetorical idea, punted by men who lie about being in a place that doesn't exist, that there's an area of volume that gas at high pressure is not filling. So in conclusion, why do you say it's not possible? Because it violates a law of nature. To have high-pressure gas not filling volume defies gas behaviour, as described in the second law of thermodynamics. So space is fake because a space that gas isn't filling is a violation of the second law of thermodynamics. Do you understand now that space is fake?
So the second law of the thermodynamics says that a gas will distribute itself.
Yes, dispersion.
And dispersion is impossible if there's... Oh, yeah, there's no dispersion. So you're saying that there's no dispersion if there's like a big vacuum above our heads, basically.
No, what we're saying is there is no big vacuum above your head because that would be an area of volume that the high-pressure gas you are breathing would be vacating into. So if the sky was a vacuum, the very first particle of gas developed at the surface level that made its way up and out and away from the surface would continue in that vector indefinitely. So we would never develop gas pressure if we were surrounded by a vacuum, because what would it have to press on? To be pressure. But we do have gas pressure, so there must be containment. It's an antecedent-consequent relationship. In order for me to be breathing this yummy, yummy high-pressure gas that we all enjoy, there must be containment for it, as opposed to the heliocentric lie that there's an area that rockets travel into to go to the moon through. No, because the gas would also go into it. It's a law of nature. Space is fake. The reason you were discussing the fakery is because there isn't really an area of volume above your head for rockets to go to or the ISS to be in. The ISS is merely a lie in the sky, and their claims of going in rockets through sky vacuums are all lies. That's why you can't do it and have to trust the priests that they've done it and then debate whether or not the footage they give you, because you're not taking snapshots, is real or not. It isn't, because it's taking place in a sky vacuum that gas isn't filling. In their pictures, they look back at an Earth with high-pressure gas not dispersing into a 10 to the minus 17 Tor vacuum. It's ludicrous. I mean, obviously, it's also the Western world religion. You know, like the church used to have authority over people back in the day. Now, it's a different religion, but people just don't realise it. They think there's a globe Earth and a sky vacuum and men going to the heaven that used to be called heaven. It's now called space. It's obviously nonsense, but it's just a way of keeping you under control.
Yeah, if you'd like to have a look in the chat.
What's up?
At 40 minutes past the hour, Mighty Mush has dropped a little diagram in there for you.
Yeah.
It might help you understand. You can see that? Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's. It says gas pressure. Gas pressure is the force of the gas particles colliding with the walls of its container. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so your fantasy religion of a globe doesn't have that. It just has a sky vacuum with gas violating a law of nature and not dispersing into it in line with entropic law and dispersion and gas behaviour and antecedent consequence of containment. It doesn't have any of that. It's just got this area that other men that aren't you go to and lie about being in when they travel to the lights in the sky that they tell you is having all the land... All the soil's up there, right? Yeah. That's why the lie.
I thought that gas, I don't know, maybe... I thought like the container included the gas itself. That's why you get this like pressure gradient from the bottom to the top.
Can you show me gas containing gas without containment?
Well, I thought that's what... They mean when they're talking about like pressure, right?
Oh, right. Who's talking about it? Like could you cite gas, that? Yeah. Could you cite that where someone's talking about gas containing itself as its own self-contained container, as opposed to the citation that someone just read out to you about pressing on walls of a container? Do you have a citation that backs what you thought? You said they say. Who's they? Who's saying that you don't need a container other than the religion of globe? They're the ones saying you don't need a container with their religion that's got a violation of a natural law in it. They're the ones saying it.
Well, maybe the...
Hi, everybody.
Well, yo, maybe I
someone from the mock team, please mute Claire immediately. Thank you.
So maybe I've, like, conceptualized gas in a wrong manner. But I always thought that gas worked very similar to liquids. But it's just less dense, sorry. And that, like, you know, you know, when you're
sorry, I'm really sorry. My wife came in with a croissant, the last croissant. It's just walked out with it in her mouth. So I wasn't listening. I'm really sorry. Can you say all that again?
It's all right. Bon appetit to you.
Oh, I didn't get it.
Ah, oh my God. That is vile. I hope. No, I'm not going to say terrible. Anything jokey. So, I was conceptualized gas kind of the same as liquid. I don't know the difference. Because I thought that gases would just, you know, like, have you ever, like...
Before you ask me a question, stop a second. Before you start asking me a question, you don't understand the difference between gases and liquids. Okay, fundamentally, they're unbonded. If you're gases, you're free to move in all directions, all vectors, because you're not bonded to another particle. You're separate from all other particles, unbonded. Water, on the other hand, has molecular bonds. It sticks together. That's what water does. So they're fundamentally different. You don't have intermolecular bonds in gases. That's why they move freely and randomly in all directions, in all vectors, until they collide with something, either another gas particle in the contained system that they're in, or the walls of the container itself. That's how gas behaves. Liquids don't behave like that. They're fundamentally different. However, people will convolute the two by describing fluids and suggesting that when at high pressure and in high concentration, i.e. you force together all of the gas particles very closely in a small contained system, you can get them to behave somewhat like liquid. And they describe that as fluid behaviour. But at a base level, no, they're not the same thing. Gases expand in all directions, so space is fake. Because the gas expands in all directions into space. That's what gas does. Gas fills space. Yeah?
Auntie Malarkey, check out the main text chat for some of the illustrations to help you out with understanding.
Thanks. That's obviously very painful for that Claire guy. Needed to put a stop to that now, didn't he? Yeah, so space is faking. In conclusion, I don't, you could appeal to their motivations for why they've lied to you about it, and we could speculate about why, but ultimately it's just a violation of a natural law. And there are no examples that you could personally give me because you're not going to Narnia. I mean, outer space, the space gas isn't filling. Because you're not going out there. The priests are the ones that go out. The liars, the astronauts, the ones that tell you they've been there when they haven't. Because they're liars. They can't go to places that aren't real.
Well, now we're finished there. Would we like to hear from Claire and see what was so important that they had to interrupt?
I mean, you stick him to the front of the queue if you want. That's up to you.
Let's see.
Malarkey, hello, your profile pic's still cute. Mine's cuter. Get right.
Did you have something you wanted to add to the discussion, topic, Claire?
Yeah, I'm kind of a genius.
Space is this.
Pardon?
I think space exists. And we have been there.
Nobody really cares what you think.
Well, I'm disagreeing with what you say.
I care and I love you.
Why are you? There you go. I think you don't care because I'm disagreeing with you.
No, I don't know. Like, why would you think
everybody else who's not Lightning Zeus shut their mouths? And if you don't, if you're not Lightning Zeus, I've got to immediately take charge of this conversation, it seems, because it's triggered fundies. If you are not Lightning Zeus.
Oh, I am like.
I'm just trying to take charge of you so we can talk to each other. You're now causing audio chaos. I'm trying to take charge so other people don't do that again. Right, if you're one of the mods, if you're not either me or Lightning Zeus,
I'm not a mod.
Take part of this conversation.
I'm telling you just my point
Lightning
of view.
Zeus. He's not willing for me to even take charge of the conversation so we can have a reasonable conversation. He's literally rumpsing
me trying
to take
charge.
Mute Lightning Zeus. He's not a reasonable person to talk to. I got that you disagreed. That's not the end of the discussion. I'm now responding to a fundamentalist religious zealot who couldn't shut up after making a baseless assertion and declaration about what he thinks, like he isn't more than just one man. Yeah, opinions are like assholes, mate. Meanwhile, I cite natural law. Have you got a rebuttal to a law of nature known as the second law of thermodynamics? No, you absolutely haven't. You sounded like and behaved like a complete moron. Yeah? Because after you made your declaration about your faith as one man, you felt the need to continue talking indefinitely because you sense there might be something that responds to your baseless assertion, an opinion of one man, which it did, and you didn't listen to it. It came before you opened your stupid mouth. Second law of thermodynamics is what we cite, a law of nature. I'm pretty sure that trumps one stupid idiot who can't shut his mouth for more than 20 seconds for me to take charge of the rest of the fundies who also feel the need to immediately chant once they hear that what this could be taken as victory, someone disagrees. That's not your victory, son. Notice how you've been shut down based on your stupid idiot behaviour by me, a flat earther, telling you with cited natural law that your stupid religion of a sky vacuum's been debunked. I don't give a crap what you think or feel about the matter. Do I make myself clear? Now you may respond. You have my permission, Zeus. See if we get a second baseless assertion. You may respond.
Okay, I'm glad you let me respond. You sound like you was having an anger attack there. Well, you said space don't exist. Let me talk. I'll let you speak.
Now, what I'll do as soon as you use a fallacy is I'll shut your line down and point out to an audience that is open with a non sequitur about my feelings. That is not an address to the second law of thermodynamics. It's actually a fallacy. So you want to call me angry? No, I deal with dicks daily. You're one of them. And you immediately opened with a fallacy. So I talked through you to highlight to my audience that you used a fallacy. How I feel or behave has nothing to do with the second law of thermodynamics. So non sequitur fallacies won't fly. You'll be shut down immediately by me, the man in charge. So I will try again for a second attempt because you failed on your first attempt. You used a fallacy. Non sequitur fallacy. Also could be perceived as an ad hom because you addressed me and how I behaved as opposed to my argument. So strictly speaking, you, the idiot, used two fallacies in response to me. So you're damn sure I'll respond by interrupting immediately through the top of you with total justification. You're stupid. You're using fallacy. Now we'll try again for a second time. Your space religion's fake based on a law of nature. It's called the second law of thermodynamics. Hopefully you can address that rather than use a fallacy again. You may attempt for a second time. Go ahead. Or you can sit in stony silence for a few seconds.
I'm trying to talk. Why did you mute me?
I'm in charge and I've got a moderation team who will immediately stick you on mute if I'm talking and you start talking through me. That won't happen here. I'm in charge and my mod team will shut you up if, like now, your open mic interrupts me. Like it is now. You'll have a mod shutting you down quicker than you can possibly believe because that won't be tolerated. This, now, what you're doing isn't tolerated. When I'm talking, you shut your stupid mouth and your fallacy use immediately and you listen to what I have to say. Now, if you don't like it, you can go away. You can run like a coward bitch who's told me that he just believes in space after he's been cited a law of nature. And on his third, this is the third attempt to respond to it, you're asking questions about how the mod team shuts you down when you talk through me. Yeah, rather than responding to the second law of thermodynamics. So again, for the third time, I'll give you permission to respond with a rebuttal to the second law of thermodynamics that debunks your religious belief in a sky vacuum, space that gas isn't filling. You may respond.
If you ever saw me on the road in the UK, you wouldn't have...
Non sequitur, remove him from the call. Now he's threatening me because his ego's been challenged by someone smarter than him. So if you saw me on the street, mate, I'm 6'2" and built like a brick shithouse. I'd knock you the fuck out. Meanwhile, I've got a second law of thermodynamics debunking of your stupid religion of a sky vacuum. So you think I give a fuck how big you think you are? I'm debunking your entire Western world viewpoint, you stupid clown. You use three fallacies and a personal attack and then threaten me with violence. Pathetic. Get lost. You lost.
That was an insane screaming match, but only from one side. Why are you so angry, dude? I don't... Like, what the fuck, dude?
Only I get to swear. Actually, speaking of which, in a minute, I'm going to be going live to an audience, okay? So, all of you in this Discord server, please don't swear. I know I just swore at that guy because he threatened me. So, I'm going to get more aggressive in my tone to let him damn sure know who's in charge here. That's me. And if he doesn't, he's going to get told and then removed after his third attempt to actually respond beyond his religious belief. Now, what I expect when I lay down the law about what's what with your sky vacuum religion, I expect a response in terms of the evidence that's been presented by four different people here today. Now, it's a complete disrespect to those people who laid down this argument about the second law of thermodynamics very calmly. This guy chirps up, I don't believe you. My response, I couldn't give a crap what you believe, you're one man. Where does that end? Does it end in him debunking the second law of thermodynamics? No. This clown shoes hasn't debunked anything. He's told me he's going to, what, beat me up if I spoke to him like that on the street. This is how I speak generally. When I meet tossers on the street, I talk to them like this. Yeah, do it regularly. I absolutely assure you. I'm no different online to I am in person. If you meet me, you'll find me pretty bullshy if you cross me. Generally, people don't cross me. People aren't talking through me and asking why they're being muted in a server that's going out to a live stream in about 5 minutes' time. So, please don't swear once we go live, if that's good by you lot. If it isn't, you'll just get removed. I can't be running a show, even if I get irritated by someone threatening me and happen to swear.
Would you swear at him before, dude? You absolutely went nuts at him. Like, that's not okay. How is that okay to anyone?
How is what okay?
Well, your choice is to leave. That's the thing. This is not your show. If you don't like what's happening right now, you vote with your dollars. You vote with your feet. Just get out.
I don't pay for this.
Sorry, do we have a little snowflake point, that had a complaint? Tonight... I'm sorry. Everyone clear the airways for a snowflake complaint.
I'm just saying that the community seems to be anti-malarkey.
Yeah. Nathan is a guest here in this room tonight, and he's running a show from here on YouTube. Yeah. Now we're not here to discuss maybes and what ifs and debate over Narnia like we were earlier. We're here for facts. So when he's having the discussion, and all he's being presented with is logical fallacies with insults and threats, well, then this guy is going to be muted, and this is the response he's going to get. Really simple, yeah? Come in with respect and you'll receive it.
The other person was respectful. He got shouted at.
No. He was just using logical fallacies and making statements, not answering the question.
I'm always nice to dumb people, and I expect other people not to be nice to
you. I was nice to you. The moment I put the second law of thermodynamics to anti-malarkey, if you could mute while other people are talking again, because all we're hearing is your background noise, that'd be great. No, when I presented the second law of thermodynamics to him in the same way I presented it to you, I've got to pause for a minute, Auntie. Hopefully no load of people won't pile in, because I've got to figure out who the hell's off mute making a load of background noise. Somebody who's decided that they want to ruin this discussion, clearly. Please mute if you are not talking. Now, with the exception of Auntie Malarkey, I'm expecting to see come off mute, but be on mute now while I'm talking so he doesn't ruin the audio to my show when I go live. But he's not. He's off mute permanently. He's not picking up the hint I'm putting down while I'm suggesting that he should be on mute right now while I'm talking to him. He's just not picking up subtlety. But there we go. That's life sometimes. Anyway, when the guy tells me about how I presented my argument in tone, timbre, or attitude, that is essentially an ad hominem fallacy. It's at the man. How I presented the argument, whether I seemed angry, that was his first response. So he had an opportunity to rebut my absolute refutation of his sky vacuum belief, and instead he chose to address my tone. Now that's one strike. In other words, I'm a little bit annoyed. I've gone to the effort of learning this stuff over 10 years, and this asshole comes along, strike one in my mind. I'm not saying asshole to the audience, but I'm thinking asshole because he hasn't responded to me. He's attacked my tone. So strike one. Then I point that out and give him another opportunity. And he does the same thing again with a non sequitur fallacy. Yeah? By the third attempt, he's saying, if I met you in the street, at that point, the opener is enough to get him removed from the conversation and annoy me greatly. Because what's he responding to me, the learned man who's learnt this stuff about you with your faith, your garbage nonsense faith, that you retain and want to argue with people who've studied it and figured out how wrong it is, Because what? You've got a religion and you can therefore tell me that I'm worthy of threats on the street? What a bleeding outrage. It's absolutely justified that I'm angry with him when he's leveled up each of the things that I'm rightful in being outraged at. He's leveled it up every single time, notch by notch, to the point where any reasonable person would be very angry with him. Especially when you're trying to enlighten him. I'm trying to help him out, right? Poor sod, caught up in this Western world lie about a sky vacuum with men in it. Nah, they just replaced the old heavens and how they used to control you back then with what the sky was. It's just now you think there's soil up there. I mean, it's absurd. But fine, he can tell me he just doesn't believe me and then not have anything to counter our actual arguments with, resulting in an end product of him threatening how he'd behave with me on the street. That's sad and justified in my disdain toward him. You know what else I'll add to that? People like that, I hate. I despise that person. Like, I have a hatred, a deep felt hatred for him. Why wouldn't I? He literally threatened me. Because I told him about a law of nature. Yeah? Why wouldn't I hate someone like that? He's worthy of being despised. Yeah, what? You're going to question about me swearing,
bro,
maybe?
Are you all right?
No, I'm not. I spent 10 years dealing with people like him. Absolute disgraceful scum who literally, you heard him threaten me. Why aren't you questioning the fact that a man has just threatened another man over the second law of thermodynamics? Does that not even register with you?
I mean, I heard that British people are subtle. Maybe, like, that is a threat to you. Like, he said that you wouldn't be rude, like, to him in real life.
And that addresses entropy.
Rude online, and a lot of people are, like, kind of nice.
Yeah, and that addresses entropy, does it? Because it seems you haven't listened to the point I just made.
No,
it doesn't. So it's known as a non sequitur fallacy and ad hom fallacy. It's at the man, only me. You haven't finished. It's at the man, ad hominem. That's a fallacy. It wasn't addressing my argument, addressing me. It's non sequitur. How I've delivered the argument isn't relevant to the argument. It's non sequitur. So he's used two fallacies. Irritating. Well, you're going to defend him? No. No, we're here to educate people. Now, maybe you don't like it when I point out that the people we're having to educate are ignorant. They are. That guy was ignorant. Another word for ignorant is stupid, dumb, foolish, moronic. Now, I don't give a crap which word I use after he's demonstrated to be any of those things. I will, with righteous indignation, point out to somebody who is ignorant just how ignorant they are. Because I'm not. Yeah? I've built up a reputation based on being the most stupid person on the planet, according to Globeheads. And yet here I am having to tell him what's what about his fallacy use. Why? He sees me as scum and would rather punch me in the face than accept the law of nature. That's his attitude.
So basically, you're saying you're not ignorant, so you're right, right? And therefore, people should accept all the facts you're saying. I mean, I just came in here. I'm not saying that that's what you're saying. I'm just, like, asking. Is that what you're saying?
No. Y'all are just trying to look for something wrong with what Nathan's saying, and you're not even trying to interpret the content he's giving you.
Yo.
Okay. Hello.
Hello. Didn't get an interruption when asking for it. Just asked the guy to say hello in an introduction. Got the hello and this is something or other in the middle of my intro. Thank you for that, whoever that was. What was your complaint? Too long? Too long an intro? Dude that started talking before I finished the intro. What was your issue? No, just a brave soul that likes talking with other people talk, like I am now.
Sorry, I believe it was Ski.
Ski?
I muted him too late. Yes.
Ski? Did you have something you wanted to add, my friend?
Ski.
Clearly not. Just when I'm talking. Fantastic. Any evidence of a...
I thought it was Sky.
Guy? Either way. We'll see. Maybe he'll start talking next time I'm back into something. We'll see how it goes. Any evidence you can have gas pressure without a container? Dudes in Discord, yeah, with a globe belief. We're asking for evidence that you can have a sky vacuum without containment, gas pressure, like we all breathe. Any evidence of that? Garbage that you all believe in? Sky vacuum? Just your religious fundy beliefs in it, right? Cool.
Yeah, so the nature of fastly moving particles dictates such that the magnetic field they produce will cause sort of a wormhole of attraction where similar charges will create certain patterns that are akin to lines or waves, and these waves will cause collections of materials to keep moving in the wake of these particles as they move forward in space. So this causes a congregation of particles that would normally be repelled.
Is that evidence of gas pressure without a container?
That is how waves are formed. Yes, yeah, it is.
Sorry, did you have
it? He's trying to describe gravity.
Well, the container, there is a container. It's gravity.
I'm actually not trying to describe gravity.
Right,
hold on, in fact. I'm very carefully hinting towards gravity, but I'm not actually describing gravity in this case.
Can you get a bit closer to your mic? The wrong drugs, please.
I'm like literally right next to it. Hold on, let me do some things though.
So what is your claim precisely when asked if we can have gas pressure without a container?
Like I was saying, normally repelled forces that are of like magnetic charge get attracted when there is an overall net velocity, meaning a direction and a momentum towards some particles are moving in space. And when they have a lot of velocity, they tend to drag other particles in their wake by causing vortexes or wormhole-like patterns or shapes in the space fabric itself. By creating deviations and waves in the space.
Okay, that's fascinating. But gas fills space, it's a law of nature, so there is no sky vacuum, just so we're clear, regardless of that little waffle that meant nothing.
No, I agree with you. Yeah, the vacuum can never be a perfect vacuum because all the particles will attempt to fill that the space vacuum, no matter what, in an effort to spread out, but there will occasionally be congregations of particles that are more dense than the other parts of the space, right? The quote-unquote space, where there are just other less densely, more sporadically spaced out particles, right?
No, there is no sky vacuum. There's claimed to be a black area above our head that's 10 to the minus 17 torr, low pressure. But the high pressure gas that we're all breathing would have never developed in the first place if that was the case, because gas expands into whatever volume it's got. So in that theoretical, nonsensical system of a sky vacuum-based globe world, you'd have the first gas particle emerging from the ground, traveling in whatever vector it travels in, regardless of its vortices, and dragging other particles, and it would never return because it would have nothing to press on. It would just carry on in whatever vector it's traveling, still talking, carry on in whatever vector it's traveling indefinitely, never developing gas pressure. So we'd all be dead.
No, so I think you missed the part where that atmosphere developed after there was already a massive gravitational body, aka magnetic body, that was attracting those particles. It already had a spinning velocity that was great enough to where the distance it would take between the surface of that gravitational body and the outer limits of it were great, such that anything within them is literally stuck within that field.
Okay, so
because the magnetic field is so great.
Do you have any scientific evidence of gravity?
Yeah, starting with, like I said, magnetic fields. I mean, you can cause gravity right now just by speaking. Like, you talking right now is creating gravity.
What?
This guy is a lunatic. Yeah. I don't know why we're talking to him. Okay. That's absurd.
Okay, you're a fucking lunatic. I can say the same thing to you. I don't care. Just because you call someone a
lunatic. Ask again, hopefully in a calm voice before the ad homs start. So we're asking for scientific evidence of gravity, and what you gave us was talking creates gravity, which tends to suggest to me that you don't understand what the question is. So maybe I'll ask a different question, or slightly different question. It's going to be subtle. Hopefully you can cope. Do you know what scientific evidence is?
So believe it or not, that wasn't my response to your question. That was the thing I said after you ignored my original response to your question, after I got an ad hom from your friend over there. So don't tell me that I'm giving you the ad homs when I literally just got directed an ad hom towards me for giving my response to your question that you thoroughly ignored. And then I gave a different response because you ignored that response. Statement
that talking causes gravity.
It does. Everything causes gravity. all matter moving causes gravity. And I gave a reason for that, but it was ignored, which is why I said that in the first place. Do you understand what I'm saying?
What I asked in response to that, hold on, John. Hold on, just one second, John. What I'm asking for in response to your claim that somehow this is gravity, first of all, which gravity?
Gravitational waves.
That's not a type
deviations in space-time fabric itself.
I'm responding to you. That's not a type of gravity. So you don't know which gravity.
Yeah, there's no types of gravity.
Let's just keep on talking, hopefully without constant incessant interruption from somebody who's wrong and doesn't know what they're talking about.
You just interrupted me.
Yeah, that's because you've said something incorrect. I asked you what type of gravity.
Okay, you
said,
did too.
And now you're
no
still talking
because
you detect that there's going to be something embarrassing exposing your ignorance. So probably best if you keep talking indefinitely. That way it won't be the case that your ignorance is highlighted by me. No, it absolutely will be. Who's the guy that bleated in the pre-show? That's strike one, mate. Yeah, he's not getting sworn at yet, but that's definitely strike one. Now, what I'm going to do now for the intolerable, ignorant moron who's just interrupted incessantly when asked for which type of gravity he's referring to and responded with waves. That's not a type of gravity. Clearly, you are ignorant. You can't even define which gravity you're talking about. So when we get into the nitty-gritty of how that gravity functions, we're not going to be talking on the same level because you're ignorant of what you're claiming. You think you're claiming gravity creates a container for gas to defy natural law. I respond, what's your scientific evidence of gravity? You didn't have an answer. You talked about how the conversation had gone and whether or not you've been accused of an ad hom. Okie dokie. That isn't scientific evidence of gravity, so we've made a second attempt. We haven't got any success there either. So I've asked you, what type of gravity? And you've said waves, that's not a type of gravity. So, now I've summarised the situation. I'd like you to actually either concede you don't know what the hell you're babbling about because you'd have told me by now, or hopefully in this little interlude you've done a little Google search to find out what the types of gravities are so you can tell me. We'll see. You may respond. Which type of gravity were you referring to? I'll be asking for the scientific evidence once we find out.
My response was there's no types of gravity. Also, I did have an answer earlier.
Sorry, you're not going to now take charge of the conversation. No, you don't get to make baseless assertions and carry on regardless like that flies. There's no types of gravity. Oh, really? Let me enlighten you, the ignorant, globe-believing numpty who's going to make baseless assertions because he's got a belief in a force that's not a force that you can think of as a force, end quote, George Musa, Scientific American. You see, in the current rhetoric, as of the last 109 years, there isn't a force of gravity at all. End quote, Professor Brian Cox. It's been superseded, that type of gravity known as Newtonian, with a different type of gravity known as Einsteinian. Now, had you, the babbling buffoon who hasn't got the slightest idea but feels justified in interrupting me incessantly with his ignorant psychobabble about garbage that he made up on the spot and in no way comports with Einsteinian or Newtonian gravity. You think you've got some force creating containment for gas pressure, do you, son? No, you don't even know what gravity is. You've just boldly declared to an audience that there are no types. Oh, really? So when I tell you about a type called Newtonian that is a force of mass attracting mass, or the type called Einsteinian that is a pseudo-Riemannian bent space-time geometry, you're going to tell me there aren't different types of it? No, you're just stupid, lad. You're getting corrected by a flat earther who knows better than you. It doesn't create a container, it's not even a force, end quote George Musa. There isn't really a force of gravity at all, end quote Professor Brian Cox. So it certainly isn't a container for gas. You'd need a container for containment. And your heliocentric religion with a sky vacuum doesn't have that. Gravity is not a force, end quote George Musa, Scientific American. So it certainly won't be forcing the gas to do a damn thing beyond its natural behaviour described in the second law of thermodynamics, which is disperse into space. Space is fake. Now, maybe, given that your gravity garbage rebuttal hasn't in any way changed the behaviour of gas, that is to say it disperses into areas of volume, maybe you could actually try again. We know you don't know what gravity is, so don't rinse and repeat or you'll instantly be removed from the debate. Gas fills space. Second law of thermodynamics.
Okay, you told me to look it up. I did. It says there's only...
You may respond. Second law of thermodynamics.
There's only one type of gravity. Google literally says. I don't know why you told me to Google it when Google literally says you're wrong. Why did you tell me that I should have Googled it when the first thing on Google says, I literally typed in types of gravity and it says there is only one type of gravity. So How are your ad homs looking now, man? You literally just strawmanned me and so
when you've just described what Google said on your first search of it, I've been studying the subject for 10 years. There are two types. In fact, there are five. The specific gravity, Newtonian gravity, Einsteinian gravity. God, I can't remember. Quantum gravity. Oh, what's the fifth one? What's the fifth one? Einsteinian, Newtonian, specific, quantum. What's the fifth? There's five types. I can't remember. Nevertheless, yeah, you're just wrong, and your quick Google search doesn't trump 10 years of research on the subject matter. So, no, mate, you're just dumb.
There's just gravity.
Dude, you literally told me to Google it, so I...
Dude, there's four types I just named on the spot. I can't remember the fifth, dude, but there's definitely different types. Einsteinian and Newtonian, specifically, are the most recent heliocentric types, dude. You're just dumb, dude. Yeah, you're just being schooled by a flat earther who knows more about your own religion than you do. Don't have to like it. You're being exposed as a clown, like all clowns we deal with. I've dealt with people like you for 10 years. You're no exception. You're not smart. You're a guy who addresses other people as dude and thinks that you've got one type of gravity because you don't know better. That's ignorance. Don't have to like it. Thank you to Jardo for the super chat. Really appreciate the support. He says, scroll up a little bit. Now I know why a shift a little in time every time I fart. Okay. Clearing the gas from my bowel causes a massive indent in a space-time. If you say so, Jardo. Thank you for the super chat. Whatever.
Can you cite the law that says that gas must expand into space?
Second law of thermodynamics, I cited it multiple times.
It doesn't say anything about gases expanding into space.
Yeah, it does. I
can give Are you saying that gas doesn't fill space?
Go ahead, John. You feel free. I don't want to deal with Brenda.
Okay. Reading one.
The second law of thermodynamics doesn't mention anything about gases.
And can you demonstrate gas not filling the space?
The second law says nothing about gases.
No, we're not going there yet. You made a statement that gas doesn't fill space.
I asked you to cite the law that states that gases must expand into space. There is no such law.
There's no such law.
That's right. The second law doesn't mention gas.
I think it's... I'm just saying it out of memory because I'm not looking it up, but it's higher microstates move it... Or it's
I can't understand.
A larger amount of microstates moving into a higher available amount of microstates. Yeah, that's gas filling space, Brenda. That's what that's the description of.
Unless what? Unless what?
There was no unless because it's a natural law, Brenda. Right?
No, there's conditions. There's conditions attached to that.
It's a natural law.
Unless
it's not an
acted upon by a force.
But you got a religious force.
Yeah, the force of gravity.
No. I'm sorry, wrong. But he's not a force.
Isn't a reply.
It is absolutely
not a reply.
Not a force.
I gave quotes that you've obviously ignored that came in the last 3 minutes. There isn't really a force of gravity at all. End quote, Professor Brian Cox.
Yeah, that's correct. Gravity
it's
can be considered.
She's flipping the burden on me like somehow I got to prove gravity doesn't exist. It's an absurdity. She's just trying to flip the burden and say I got to prove that gravity doesn't exist. No,
yeah, what's
that's gravity? Stupid. I'm not going to answer that.
It's your claim.
But the second law of thermodynamics is our claim. Well, let's hear what Yale have got to say about it. If you could just,
I'm sorry, Brenda,
I'm going to cite the source, Yale. We'll hear what they've got to say about it. If you can just pop yourselves on mute, everybody in the server and on G+, for just a moment.
Describe to you the first law of thermodynamics. The context was, we're going to study a system, that's our thermodynamic system, And for all our purposes, you can imagine that to be some amount of ideal gas trapped inside this piston and cylinder combination. The gas has a certain pressure and a certain volume, and we represent that by a point in this diagram.
So just so we're all clear, the guy's giving a lecture on thermodynamic laws. And at the moment, just for the audience's benefit, he's actually detailing, I believe, PV equals NRT. But nevertheless, he moves on to the second law of thermodynamics, just so we're all clear what's being talked about.
That defines the state. That's called the state of the gas. We want to look at bulk macroscopic properties of which pressure and volume is a complete pair. That's all you need. I think I reminded you that you don't need a third axis for temperature because we have this equation, PV equals NRT. So if you know P and V, you don't need temperature as another variable.
And just for the audience's clarity, V is volume, the space available to the gas, just so we're all clear.
That's called the equation of state. You can use this all the time. Whenever the gas has got a pressure and volume, feel free.
So just so we're clear, this guy's giving a university lecture at Yale, and he's specifically talking about gas within the descriptions of gas and how it behaves with these laws, thermodynamic laws. I think Brenda's done in this conversation. I mean, we'll listen just because it's only a couple of minutes long and it's only got about, I don't know, a minute and a half left. But that's the end. She's just a lying piece of garbage that made up crap that wasn't true. The guy at Yale giving a lecture paid by your state that you all get behind and believe in makes it absolutely explicitly clear in his examples that he's using gas. He just said it.
I heard nothing that
equation
said
of
that
state. You can use this all the time. Whenever the gas has got a pressure and volume, feel free to use PV equals NRT. I take a box and I put some gas molecules on one side, and there's a partition holding them in that side. Then I remove this partition and I wait a little bit, then I know the gas fills up.
Okay, so he's describing gas dispersion. On the blackboard, it's got second law written specifically, and he's detailed how gas fills space by drawing a gas in containment next to a vacuum, removing the barrier, and the gas fills up, end quote. So the second law on blackboard at Yale most assuredly is what he's detailing when detailing the second law of thermodynamics with gas that Brenda denied. No such law. They're teaching it at Yale. Just remove her from the conversation. I don't want to talk to her anymore. She's only here to deceive my audience and lie to them. The man at Yale isn't lying when he describes gas filling space when detailing very specifically the second law of thermodynamics as written on the blackboard by this man at Yale. Okay? No longer part of this conversation, my friend Brenda. I don't want to talk to you anymore.
This premix and that premix over there real quick, just so we don't forget it, because it's been getting forgotten and shit. So, yeah.
Are they bringing another one or just...
As far as I know, just one. And because this is like gel and Bayrite, instead of...
I think he's hot micing.
Whatever.
Sorry, guys.
Nevertheless, Brenda's argument has been refuted. She says nothing to do with gas. The second law of thermodynamics violation description of entropic increase would have gas fill space as just lectured at Yale. Everything to do with gas, everything to do with the second law. It said second law on the blackboard, and its description used gas and how it fills a vacuum, a space available to it. V in PV equals NRT, the volume. So, in conclusion, we are correct. It is absolutely a gas law. It is absolutely how gas behaves. It is lectured by Yale. Brenda, on the other hand, is a half-wit clown who is here to lie to people and just did. Therefore, I don't want to engage with her anymore in conversation. She is fundamentally just been demonstrated to be a liar when she said, number one, the law doesn't exist. Number two, it has nothing to do with gas. Yes, it does exist. Yes, it's just been described by a Yale lecturer with gas as the example. Remove her from the conversation. She no longer has a place at the table.
Yeah, she's removed. But further to that, Nathan, I'd like to say that she also said that It's a not an irreversible change due to the fact that a force could be applied to it. Now, that's an incorrect statement. Well, let's hear in the chat. 21 just one sec. Minutes past the hour.
Just one sec. Let's hear what Yale has to say.
Yes.
Now, take that's like perfume leaking out of the bottle. Hot and cold, when mixed, will never separate back into hot and cold. A gas, that genie that got out of the bottle won't go back. This gas that came out won't go back. There's a whole lot of processes which we call irreversible.
There is a whole lot of processes described by analogy with him, with perfume gas leaking out of the bottle and never going back in. An irreversible process. Once gas developed from ground level, escaped into the vacuum, it would never return, like perfume leaking out of a bottle. Like the second law of thermodynamics description of entropic dispersion. Like being lectured about here specifically with gas dispersion and how that process is irreversible. What's it that Brenda the Globe Believer had to say to the audience? Not irreversible. I see. That's why she hasn't got a place at the table.
I would like to say...
Go ahead, John.
I would like to say what she thought was a loophole in her unless was going to appeal to a downward vector force that she would say is gravity. But down is with respect to a horizontal plane of reference. You think you live on a ball. So, no, it's not a downward force. You're wrong.
100 people watching. Please share the show if you've not done so already. A very warm welcome to all of you who've just joined us. If so, you've probably only joined because lots of people in the live audience have shared the show. So thank you for sharing. Thank you for joining. Please share the show if you haven't done so already.
Is the concept of an irreversible process, does that only apply to a closed system?
The description in entropy he just gave applied in a closed system, but equally gas will always disperse into volumes, as in PV equals NRT, like he explained.
Yeah, that expansion of the gas, as AJ said, is an irreversible process, right? But if you apply work from outside the system, you can reverse the process. It's only within the closed system where entropy must increase that you cannot reverse an irreversible process.
Well, it's not quite like that.
If you have an open system, you can reverse those processes.
Right, in an open system, like what?
Yeah.
What open?
The universe as a whole, its entropy will increase, but you can decrease the entropy of that gas and push it back into the other side of the container.
Well, you're begging the question of a sky.
Not without the surroundings. Not without the surroundings doing work.
Exactly. That's right.
That's correct. So now the gas does no work on the surroundings, therefore that's not possible, which means it's an irreversible change. There's nothing in the surroundings that can recompress those gases.
In a closed system, correct.
Nature wouldn't do
in
that
in an open
anyway.
System. So the most widely
in an open system, anything can happen, right?
The most widely cited example of an irreversible change is the free expansion of a gas into a vacuum. Although the system can always be restored to its original state by recompressing the gas, this would require that the surroundings perform work on the gas. Since the gas does no work on the surroundings in a free expansion, the external pressure is zero, so P equals O, there will be a permanent change in the surroundings. Another example of the irreversible change is a conversion of mechanical work into friction heat. There is no way by reversing the motion of weight along a surface that the heat released due to friction can be restored to the system. So both are saying they're irreversible.
Yeah,
because the external cannot perform the work required because the gas does no work on the system itself.
But you have to, I guess the key thing I was trying to bring up there is that the second law is applying to closed systems, right? That you have to look at the entire system when you consider the change in entropy of the system.
Okay, fine. So without
it's actually stated right here.
Just one sec. Yeah, I got that the first time. So you're saying, no, it doesn't behave like that in an open system. Okay, fine. Can you demonstrate to me gas pressure without a container? Without begging the question.
So Yeah, so gas pressure, right, is the pressure exerted by a gas against something resisting the gas, right? That is what gas pressure is. So it can be a container, it can be another gas, it can be anything that can resist the force of that gas.
No, you're making baseless assertions. No, you're now telling me that gas can contain gas. Right, you can have dynamic systems, but no, I'm asking you to show me, as you've suggested, that this is possible, and then when it's defined as something, in your case, open system, fine, okay. So now we're going to need an example. Without you begging the question of there being a sky vacuum, can you give me a demonstration of gas pressure without a container?
So in aerodynamic flow, we create gas pressures, right?
That's already an existing...
gas pressure is caused by other gases,
no.
Oh, you have existing pressure, yes.
That means stop.
Yes, I'll grant you.
No, I'm contradicting you because, no, that already takes place in existing gas pressure. So for that example,
yes,
you'd need to first have a contained system to have gas pressure to give that example. So can you refrain from taking... challenging you. I understand, like everybody so far on this show, when I correct their garbage nonsense that's incorrect, they like yammering through me. No, I'd prefer that when I ask you for initial gas pressure without containment, you don't take an already existing gas pressure that would require containment and then give your example taking place in already existent gas pressure. Please don't do that again. I'll ask a third time. Can you give me an example without begging the question of a sky vacuum of gas pressure without a container?
Well, if you vaporize a solid, it will generate and cause it to generate a gas. That gas will have pressure, even though it's expanding to fill the vacuum around it. There will be pressure in that gas. It will eventually expand and dissipate, but there will be pressure in the gas while it's expanding.
I heard. So the first gas particle comes out of the ground in the heliocentric garbage world of a sphere Earth. The very first gas particle leaves the ground. According to you, after it's left the surface, it is, strictly speaking, creating a pressure as it travels in the vector. Yeah, fine. But it's going to still... I'm still talking, rebutting your garbage. Yeah, I'm still talking. I know it's painful to hear your garbage ripped to shreds by a flat earther. I know it'd be easier if you just carried on talking through the top of me. I understand. I've done this for a long time. Meanwhile, that first gas particle, there's the second attempt to refute his garbage. This is obviously a zealot with a globe belief he can't relinquish and will not tolerate anything that challenges it. No, even with you your example, where the very first gas particle, you're just going to have to mute him because it's the third attempt to refute him. In his example, as the gas travels out from a solid releasing gas upon phase change, according to him, when it creates the gas is... ipso facto, developing a gas pressure because it's gone from a seemingly static state, not absolute zero, let's be clear, and then moving, therefore pressure. Fine, I'll agree. It's still doing what gas does, regardless of you defining that as it's moving, it's now developed a gas pressure. Yeah, fine. But unless it presses on something, it's going to continue in that vector, as per the second law of thermodynamics, into the sky vacuum. So this... solid, yes, turned into a gas. Now I'm summarizing because you interrupted it three times. I'm having to summarize it. It's dragging out the process. You interrupting. Because it's been changed from a gas, from a solid into a gas, and then left the Earth's surface into the sky vacuum, 10 to the minus 17 tor at sea level. It's never going to come back. It's going to change vector, never, because it's got nothing to collide with. And so will be the case with the second gas particle and the third gas particle, regardless of you saying, well, it's developed pressure when it went from being solid to gas. Yeah, fine. Still moving in the same vector and dispersing. So we'd have no gas on Earth. Outer space is still fake. Gas fills space.
Yeah. So we just backpedal to something your guy from, was it Harvard, the little clip you played before?
Yale.
He said that PV equals NRT applies to any volume you care to choose. So at any point in time, that expanding gas will obey PV equals NRT. You can draw an arbitrary boundary around the gas, and within that boundary, PV equals NRT will be satisfied.
Stop. When did he say arbitrary boundary? I didn't hear him say that.
He said any volume.
Yeah, to have a volume, it would have to be in containment.
No.
Oh, okay. So, no, fine. No, fine. So you say no. You say open system. Okay, so let's take the volume V as outer space. Because there's no containment for globe Earth, right? So the V would be space then.
Eventually, yes, the volume
so,
will
so gas would fill the space.
The
so yeah, so
zero.
I'm winning. No need to rumpus me. Yeah, so V in PV equals NRT, the heliocentric sky vacuum religion, would be the entirety of space, and gas would be filling that volume in line with that entropic law, regardless of your arbitrary ascribing of a non-container around the volume of space. Good for you! Yeah, gas would still be filling that V. It's the volume that the gas can fill and will, according to that Yale lecturer, when he described gas dispersion into the volume. Your volume would be the whole of space! And gas would be filling it. It isn't. It's a violation of natural law still. Hope that's clear.
Well, it's only a violation of natural law if it stops expanding and nothing is stopping it.
Like at the Kármán line.
If something like is at, applying,
like at the, like
doing,
at the Kármán,
applying a force
like
to
at
that
the Kármán,
gas.
Excuse me. Like at the Kármán line in your religion. That sort of non-arbitrary barrier that's
sorry,
not a barrier with a non-container. Maybe if you chant through the fact that I'm literally ascribing your own words to your religious belief of non-containment at the Kármán line. Yet you do have that violation of natural law. The arbitrary volume you ascribe to our atmosphere oxymoron sphere-shaped air is at the Kármán line. It's not a barrier. It's not a container. It's not doing anything. It's a completely arbitrary value ascribed to a sphere Earth that's been measured flat to give you that inference. Meanwhile, that's arbitrary. The volume is actually space. Some arbitrary made-up volume at the Kármán line won't be the volume because the volume is space. The space it can fill. The volume available. That would be space. We'd all be dead.
Exactly.
Outer space is fake.
You're spot on. The Kármán line has no physical bearing on anything at all. It's just an arbitrary decision point where the vacuum is low enough to say it's good enough to be a vacuum.
No, that's a second law of thermodynamics violation. Gas fills vacuums. It's a space, a volume for the gas to fill, and gas fills it unless it's restricted by a barrier for it to press on and develop pressure. Okay. Now, in the heliocentric model, while you chant through my response that destroys your religious deceit that you seem to be peddling now, because, no, mate, it's a violation of natural law, that which you've just described with an arbitrary volume that isn't containing the gas, when the actual volume in your heliocentric religion is space, all of it, the volume of space that the gas would be filling, but just isn't, according to your priests, speaking about areas where they look back on high-pressure gas surrounded by a black area of a volume and go, wow, look at the amazing view I have from Narnia. No, they don't. It's a violation of natural law. That gas that they're looking back at in the form of clouds on a blue marble, that would be expanding into the 10 to the minus tor, 17 tor vacuum around it in the black area that they claim is around that garbage nonsense that you believe in. It's a violation of natural law. Nothing you've said overcame that.
So I'm sitting here and I pull out my phone and where's it gone? And my phone tells me the air pressure on my desk is 1,002 hectopascals, 1,002.1. I lift my phone up and I touch it to the ceiling and it's 1,001.9. That's dropped a couple of fractions of a hectopascal floor to ceiling. It does this all the time. Doesn't matter what the weather is, whether it's hot or cold. There's a pressure difference between the floor and the ceiling in my room. Same outside. Doesn't matter if it's windy or if I'm in the sun or whatever. There's this pressure gradient. Why don't I have this constant upwards flow of gas from the floor to the ceiling caused by the second law of thermodynamics?
No. Sorry.
It's not the question. The question should be.
He's appealing to Delta X.
The question shouldn't be.
Regulars.
Right. Yeah. The question shouldn't be why do I have this thing as a result of pressure?
Sorry, John, just before
why
you carry on.
This thing that...
John, I've already appealed to him once. His first example was differentials, presumably with the Bernoulli effect within a contained system that already had gas pressure, and now he's attempted it for a second time. Maybe he thought a second crack of the whip for something I've specifically asked him. Now he's going to interrupt. He's detected that there's something embarrassing coming his way when he's already asked, like the one-trick pony he is, to not do this. Yeah, so why do I have a gas pressure gradient? Well, you'd first have to have a gas pressure to have gas pressure gradients. You'd need containment. And there's the second interruption from a fundamentalist religious zealot having his ignorance and second attempt to appeal to already inexistent gas pressure that will develop a secondary cycle to give us gradients. Yeah, all of these require containment in the first instance. What you have done in a fallacious manner is appeal to Delta X rather than answering or rebutting the actual fact of the matter, that to have the gas pressure to develop a gas pressure gradient, for you to appeal to me to answer why we have a gas pressure gradient, that's a delta of gas pressure, when I've already told you not to do that, just seems like some asshole who doesn't really listen and has only got one trick up his sleeve to appeal to an argument that already takes place with an existing gas pressure that would require containment. So your appeal to delta X gas pressure gradients fails miserably. By the way, shockingly, this might, I've got something to summarise after your loss. That wasn't an invitation for you to start yammering after your pathetic, fallacious attempt to try and get one over on me with Delta X. After I've absolutely ripped you a new asshole, I'm going to make a further point to you, the guy who now thinks it's an invitation to talk. No, Mr. Ignorant, you've already been told now twice, don't do that. So I'm telling you off. The first time was a warning, now I'm having to tell you off. Listen to me, one-trick pony. Don't appeal to Delta X. In order to have gas pressure in the first place, you need containment. For you in a sky vacuum, you have a volume, and there he goes again. He doesn't like it. He's belligerent, in spite of his demonstrated ignorance, and despite of his rebellion against absolutely affirmed and understood facts that he won't appeal to Delta X after his first airplane wing attempt. No, mate, you're stupid and belligerent. You're getting told off by a flat earther. Does this come as a shock? Does it? When you appeal to Delta X like you're smart, telling me that you've raised up your phone? No, mate, it's not my first rodeo, and you're going to be shocked by this. That was not an original argument. Believe it or not, I have heard other complete idiots appeal to Delta X for a gas pressure gradient no less than 1,000 times. So perhaps you thought you were smart. Perhaps you thought you were original. You're not. You are standard rank-and-file dumb fuck globe believer who feels that this might also be an invitation for you to talk. No, you're getting told off, son. Next time, for the third time, don't appeal to Delta X. When the volume of your sky vacuum is described in natural law as an area gas would fill, prior to us being able to develop a pressurised system, for you to then appeal to the delta of that gas pressurised system in containment. Now I've finished. You may respond after getting my goat up. Idiot.
Cool. So I guess I've got a question. What is Delta X that we're talking about here?
Are you having me on? Gas pressure?
No.
And gas... pressure.
Delta P.
Oh, maybe if you keep talking through me having to answer your stupid, ignorant question that doesn't know the difference between the principal factor, which is gas pressure, and a delta of that principle, which is a gas pressure gradient. First, that's before the delta, as he starts talking again, of course. He's an idiot. No, you're being educated, Dumbo. Can you shut your mouth? You asked, I'm answering you. The reason I'm having to answer you is because you're ignorant. Now, when you're ignorant, that means shut your bleeding mouth, open your friggin' ears, and listen to the answer to the question you just asked. Otherwise, you'll be removed because you're getting my blood pressure too high. You're irritating. You're a standard moron who irritates me with your stupidity, your questions that you should know the answers to, given you're arguing this stuff, with Delta X. First, gas pressure. That requires the antecedent of containment for you to press on. Then, and only then, do you have the delta of gas pressure, which is a gas pressure gradient. Didn't get there quite without him talking, obviously. Triggered. Or is that you, John?
It wasn't me.
Also, my bad. It was me. I was going to say, also, when he appealed to raising his phone up, that was with respect to a horizontal plane of reference. He thinks he lives on a sphere.
No, it was vertical.
Stop using the word.
It was up to vertical.
He's chanting through you. What he's pointing out is that in order for you to describe up on a globe, isn't possible because you have no horizontal plane of reference to have an up in the vertical perpendicular to it. Now, as he's obviously got his eye quite open, we're just waiting for his turn to talk. Standard rank and file moron globally. They're just thinking that it's his invitation to talk when he's being educated about his dumbass assertion of up perpendicular to a horizontal plane of reference for his phone to give him an altitude to tell him how up from a flat plane it is. Now, while I go on, thank you, John, by the way. Cool. Very cool. Back on track. While I go on to utilize your example of raising in elevation with respect to sea level, that's a horizontal plane of reference, a measured flat earth, for you to give how high your phone was, to then tell me about how Delta X will somehow solve a sky vacuum violation of natural law. No, your Delta X was crap. We've heard it 1,000 times. It does not in any way overcome the fact you need a container for gas pressure. The fact that volumes of areas of your sky vacuum would be where the gas would all be, and we'd all be dead. Nothing you've said has overcome that, or is in any way original. Meanwhile, what you did have in your example was a flat earth proof. When you gave the height of your phone, the height was with respect to sea level. A flat earth only declaration. So you proved the flat earth when you gave us the height of your phone. Do you know what you should have said on a globe?
Is it my go now?
No, I'm asking you a question. That was a statement. It wasn't an invitation. You're showing how stupid you are. Nobody had a question mark at the end of anything. I made a load of statements. I'm asking you now after those statements. And he still thinks it's his turn to talk. No, it isn't. But I will ask you a question. What should you have said instead of proving a flat earth with up? Do you know what the term should have been for you on a globe with your globe faith derived from flat earth measurements?
Vertical.
No, that's flat earth requiring. We've just gone through that literally 30 seconds ago.
Verticals.
Maybe if you weren't talking while I went through it 30 seconds ago. Vertical is perpendicular. Shut him up. Mute him. He's a chanting zealot. He doesn't like being wrong. He's like your standard everyday 1,000 times repeating Delta X gas pressure gradient moron. Like all of them. He thinks it's his turn to talk. It isn't.
Silence him.
Vertical is a description that is perpendicular to horizontal. Now, in terms of having a plane of reference to describe how high you are from it, that is sea level. Now, that is not globe-based. Now, after detailing this for a second time, and you just not understanding because you talk the whole time, I ask, after making declarations of fact, not asking you a damn thing, now I'm asking you what you should have said on a globe. You didn't know. You said vertical. So we, the learned people in your religion, will tell you. For you, it's out. Out from the centre of a sphere. Obviously, that's not going to give you a height with respect to sea level on a phone that doesn't use that. That's a flat earth prerequisite, as he chants, through the devastating fact that the prerequisite is a flat earth and sea level. He needs to say out. I asked him, he didn't answer, he said vertical incorrectly. It needs a flat earth for that. But what, it's still your turn to talk while I'm still talking? No, I'm trying to teach you stuff. You didn't listen the first time. You obviously haven't listened the second time. It was out, the answer to my question. It'd be nice if you acknowledged that which you got wrong when you tried to comport with your religious belief of being on a sphere. Where you said up, you proved a flat earth with respect to sea level. You should have said out. Do you understand?
Out, okay. So, yeah. I don't want to divert from the gas thing for too long, but if I grab a plumb bulb, right, how does that know what horizontal is?
Perpendicular to it is what you get when you dangle a plumb bob.
There's a follow-up question
in response. It's not just you leading the questions. You asked me about something, and I'm asking you something in response. It's not just you take charge of the questioning that's benign. Why?
Oh, sorry, I missed the question. Like, you went on for quite a while and I didn't...
It's my show. Is this guy stupid? I'm running a show. This is my show. You think I've been talking a bit long, do you? Shocking. You know, people pay me to talk. I earn my living talking, but what you think you should run the show, do you, Dumbo? No, mate, you're completely idiotic and appeal to Delta X like thousands of others before you. What, you think that you should have the mic to hear what my audience has heard from other idiots like you 1,000 times before? No, mate. No, you're not in charge. I am. Yeah. Meanwhile, out is what you should have described. You went, okay, like you didn't seem to want to acknowledge it. And are now asking me about plumb bobs. I respond, why would you ask about this flat earth proving concept with perpendicular to horizontal, vertical, plumb bobs? This is a flat earth proof. I asked why you would be asking about this flat earth proof. I don't get it.
So, yeah, so my thing about vertical, Nathan, is that vertical is a physical property of the world around us, right? Plumb bobs work on vertical. Builders' levels use vertical. Everything's trying to go up or down based on something that's pulling them, right? Horizontal is kind of an artifact that we derive from vertical. And So vertical is an inherent property of the world around us.
Right, John.
It doesn't prove that Earth is a globe.
Hold on, everyone, stop for a second.
It's just an inherent property.
Stop for a second, John.
No, yes. I haven't finished. You had a good crack, mate.
Maybe if you were in charge, you'd be able to stop anybody whenever you liked. Meanwhile, it's my bleeding show, and I'll stop you as I damn well see fit, as I invite somebody to challenge you. That would be John. Unfortunately, the last time he tried to challenge somebody, his mic was a bit of a train wreck, so I'll give him another opportunity to do so, as it's my show. But maybe that's objectional to you. Yeah, we know. I've tried to communicate with you, and you chant through me while I try and educate your dumbass. I know what you're like. You're the same as everybody else who comes here with a globe belief. But I'm still going to invite one of my panel to debate with you, based on what you've said about horizontal and vertical. And how that is a prerequisite for an Earth that we live on. Yeah, I didn't interrupt you. I would have said, welcome to flat Earth, had I have interrupted you when you said that, because that is a flat Earth prerequisite. However, I will be passing the mic over to my panel member named John, otherwise known as Refracted Curvature. Okie dokie, John.
Hey, John.
Hey, yeah.
Lovely to have a friendly and open chat.
That you can show with a plumb bob, right? You can show.
Sorry, can you say that again?
Maybe when I told this dickhead that I was handing the mic to John, he, because he's stupid, like really idiotic, doesn't understand simple English.
Wow.
Maybe he thought that was his invitation to immediately start talking. Now, I am going to give you one more opportunity to actually listen to what we say. And if you interrupt, I'm not even going to do it. I'm going to suggest that the next time this asshole interrupts one of us, you just remove him. Because it's becoming unlistenable for my audience. We're not getting anywhere. It's just him yammering when I've told someone else they're going to get the mic. I'll try that again for the guy who's very stupid, the globe believer, standard fare, idiot globe believer. I will now slow it down a little so he can hopefully listen and pay attention and understand and comprehend. I'll now pass the mic to the same guy I just introduced 2.5 minutes ago before you started yammering thinking it was your turn. It weren't. John. Refracted Curvature. Go ahead.
God damn.
Vertical is a description.
Was that him interrupting? Was that sorry, John. Was that him?
No, it wasn't me. Sorry, John.
Whoever interrupted,
you have to speak up.
Can you not tell by the type of question? Was that him interrupting is obviously directed not at you. Now, the guy who did interrupt needs to be server muted because obviously they're just playing silly buggers now. Thank you.
It was Blue, and Blue's been muted. And sorry, Dazza is just asking. He's finding Refracted Curvature there a little bit quiet. Is he able to maybe turn his mic up or just maybe speak a little bit closer to his mic, if that's possible?
Go ahead, John.
All right. Well, up and down on the vertical aspect is with respect to the horizontal, just as moving along the horizontal is with respect to the vertical. These ideas are codependent and relying upon the other one for its own existence. It is not just a concept that we made up with respect to vertical, because there's this thing that exists we call the horizon, and that is how we establish a 90 degrees perpendicular with that piece of string. So we didn't make up horizontal. We see the horizon, and we develop that concept from the horizon. That's not true, that horizon, that horizontal is what we just made up because of vertical. No.
Yeah, so I agree that horizontal and vertical have that relationship. That's true. But I guess my perspective, John, is that the vertical can be established without reference to anything. You can be in the dark. You can be, you can. You don't need horizontal to establish a vertical. And it's a physical characteristic of the world around us. And, yeah, you're correct. It's related to horizontal that you can establish that relationship. That's fine. But vertical is in its own right and independently independently discoverable property of the world around us. So, you know, plumb bobs, just
no,
do
it's
it.
Not independent.
It is. Okay. In that
we heard you. We heard you. Now John's going to respond.
Yeah. Sorry, John. Go.
Yeah. The part where you said it's independent. No, it's not. It is dependent upon horizontal, just as horizontal is dependent upon vertical. Those concepts are interlocked, like when you're talking about pressure and temperature with gas. You're not going to be able to just arbitrarily say, it's just this one and forget everything. It's just a point on this line that I'm going to arbitrarily draw. No, you can't do that. You don't have vertical without horizontal. You don't have horizontal without vertical. And horizontal has got to be eye level or surface level in every description you're going to give. So it's a flat earth, dude. I don't know what else to tell you.
Just going to do a quick shout out. I'm really sorry. I've got a mortgage to pay. A shout out to Roger Ledwell. Don't put the cart before the donkey. Thank you for the super chat. And also Jardo, who says, membership warning in 30 seconds. I think he's going to spam the viewing public with free memberships. So check it out. Sorry to interrupt.
So, John, I don't disagree that vertical and horizontal are intrinsically related like that, and that you can derive vertical from horizontal, which is what you do with the sextant when you do the horizon dip and subtract it, you're effectively finding vertical. But vertical can also be truly found independently of horizontal.
May I ask, what are you using to find that vertical? Are you using horizontal, your eye level as a horizontal, surface level as a horizontal? Aren't you doing that?
Sorry, which horizontal are we talking about here?
There's two involved in the direction.
Obviously, your answer's troubling.
Yeah.
Try that again,
John.
About the two horizontal surface level and eye level that are absolutely required. You asked him if he's not referring to those surface level and eye. That's where we're at.
Yeah, that's it. If you're talking about dip correction, you're utilizing your eye level as a horizontal plane of reference, and so you're drawing a line from your eye to where surface level appears to meet the sky. That is a parallel plane. You have two parallel planes you're drawing for this dip correction. It's still a plane, though.
Yeah, so we probably got a bit off topic, but yeah. So we don't want to go into celestial navigation now, do we, Nathan? Or not?
You did. But what you mean is don't want to get into celestial navigation. Now it requires surface level be a horizontal plane of reference. And in order for us to do any corrections for dip as you brought it up, we'd need eye level to be parallel with it. And obviously, given that the principle of vertical is tied directly to it, vertical is going to be vertical all the way along that horizontal plane of reference. Now, this as a declaration at the end where you thought we were, what, going a bit off topic? What, off the topic that you brought up? No, you brought it up and now we're proving a flat Earth with it. Because you need horizontal planes of reference, surface level and eye level. Proving Earth is measured flat in this regard. Not off topic, you brought it up. I don't know why you'd say that, that seems really stupid. You went off topic when you brought it up and then we proved a flat Earth with it. No, we just proved a flat Earth.
Yeah, it was unintentional, I'll admit that.
I know you didn't intend to prove a flat Earth when you described horizontal planes of reference that we are measuring for elevation angles in celestial navigation with the sextant, and how they definitely need a horizontal surface level and eye level parallel with one another to prove that we are measuring a flat Earth. You unintentionally brought up a subject that proves Earth is being measured flat. I know you didn't intend to do that. You did. Earth is being measured flat, though, in that process.
Well, I would also like to invite him to check out any of the Earth curve calculators he believes in. Choose the best one, and you'll notice that what you call a tangent when you're talking to us, it's labeled with a name. It's got a specific name called circle that's drawn from the foot with respect to vertical, horizontally, out ad infinitum. So there's that line.
You broke it. You broke it when you said the most important word, surface level, the tangent.
He was just and I'm not sure where you're posting.
He broke up while he said it. Maybe if you talk through it, it won't be as painful and you won't have to listen to it. But meanwhile, the surface level in Earth curve maths, you call it a tangent sometimes, but it's actually surface level. It's labeled that way in the maths. That was his point. It's horizontal.
So you'd be also aware in the maths that once you've taken that horizontal and the elevation angle of your celestial object, you then use it to calculate the co-altitude angle, right, which is up to vertical. And then you take that co-altitude angle and effectively multiply it by 60 nautical miles per degree to get your distance to the GP. That's the fundamental geometry of celestial navigation. Yes, nautical miles per degree. As per the co-altitude angle from.
Yeah.
Sorry, John, I didn't hear you say that again.
From 90 times by 60. Yeah, that would mean that you've got 90 at the end of that triangle, though, at the base of the star, at the other end of the flat baseline, the horizontal plane of reference that we're measuring for this angle. That means that 90 degrees below the star, there is a flat Earth between you and that position below the star that you're measuring a line of sight to the star with. Horizontal baseline between you and the 90 degree point. So when you minus from 90, then you turn that angle measurement with a sextant on a boat into the co-altitude angle, which you can then times by 60 to calculate that distance 60, to that point on the ground. You don't have to yammer your yes through me. We're just pointing out how Earth's being measured flat with this. It's a flat baseline between you and the distance between the star's GP and yourself once you do that calculation. But the measurement itself requires you measure Earth as a flat plane. To just take the angle itself, the angle of elevation, is a flat Earth measurement.
Right, sorry, John, were you going to say something then?
The angle of elevation with the stick in the ground and a flat area, right? And just get your angle with the celestial object. You could do the same thing. All you need is a parallel plane with mean sea level, a parallel plane, horizontal all the way up. That's what level is. Yep. Level is your first person view of horizontal. Horizontal is like third person mathematical representation to communicate the idea of the plane we exist atop.
Yeah, the stick thing, and the length of the angle's a good one. Do you know the other backyard celestial navigation tool that you can produce without too much hassle?
This is fun and all, but we've just proved...
It's a plumb bob and a protractor.
Fun that it is. We've just proven Earth is measured flat.
So, Nathan, did you know that you can do celestial navigation?
Would it be easy if we had a quick subject change?
With a
quick, easy subject change?
With a plumb bob.
No, I'm not having the subject change and you're not in charge of the discussion. At this point... You brought up a subject. If you're not going to listen to me and conclude a point with me and just subject change, I'll highlight that. I'll lean on that. This guy's fundamentally terrified because he's a globe believer. in the fact that we have just concluded this point with an angle measurement with respect to a flat Earth. It's on screen now. Dave McKeegan, another videographer who covers this subject, fell victim to the exact same thing. Yeah? Because you can't have an elevation angle measurement on a globe. Excuse me. Why are you chanting through the top of my conclusion that Earth is being measured flat with an elevation angle measurement? Why was it that you chose that particular point to talk through me? I'll explain. It was rhetorical. It's because he's in fear of the Earth that is being measured flat with his own example. Now, rather than acknowledge that, which I'm going to ask him to do again in a moment when I finish, I'm in no doubt I'll be interrupted before I get to do it. But when I ask him for the second time, if he understood and appreciates that his own example of this angle measurement requires Earth be measured flat. And when he either acknowledges that or tries a subject change or a non sequitur again, we'll see how we go. I'll conclude with that fact in victory. We won't move on to a different question. But first, I need my opponent who brought this subject up, definitely by mistake. Obviously, we got a bit off track with him bringing up this subject that he didn't want to bring up and that. So we understand and appreciate together, all of us, that your example measures Earth flat for the elevation angle. You understand that. Before we move on, I need you to acknowledge that so I can conclude in victory. Do you understand we just measured Earth flat, son?
No, I think you're incorrect. And will you allow me to finish before you declare victory again?
I have one.
I'll take that as a yes.
I hadn't responded. Maybe if you leave a short enough pause for me to respond in the negative, that no, when you have 90 degrees to the GP of a star, that requires a flat baseline. So while you're going to yammer through the top of me, what, suggesting that I haven't already won when you and I have both got 90 degrees to the baseline and 90 degrees to your position, so we can minus that 90 in the calculation you gave. Minus from 90. Yeah, that's the 90 degree that you won't get from a curved surface.
No, what's the difference between vertical and horizontal?
So why is this a response to me saying you won't get 90 degrees from a curved surface? It's an angle measurement with respect to a baseline, and now I'm being asked about vertical and horizontal. It's an angle measurement. It's called an elevation angle. It proves Earth's measured flat. It must be to have 90 degrees to the GP of the star you're measuring, to minus it like you described in the calculation. Minus from 90, that's the degrees. You're minusing it off another right angle triangle to give you co-altitude. You explain this to us. That's a flat Earth prerequisite. You can't have 90 degrees below the star on the baseline if it's a curved surface, because it won't be an angle anymore.
Well,
you're correct. So it won't be an angle anymore. We're sorry.
We
can measure it from the vertical though, right? It is perfectly possible to do celestial navigation relative to verticals.
Oh, so you're saying if you take it with a plumb bob, you've already got the co-altitude?
Exactly.
And what are you calculating? And there's my follow-up because I've already won. We're calculating for the ground position below the star. And the distance is...
You don't need to...
Sorry, what are you going to tell me I don't need to win? Because maybe if you chant through it, it won't seem like I've won when we're actually measuring ground positions below the star.
Yes.
Yeah, so that would be on the ground with a flat baseline. We're measuring that distance to draw out a flat circle of equal elevation with it. That's what we're doing with it. It must be flat because we're drawing a circle with that flat distance to the ground position. And the ground position has 90 degrees to your position. Now, I appreciate that while you wanted to decry my victory, and just for the audience's benefit, as you can see his light flashing on and on as I tell him that he's definitely lost. But in his mind, if he's talking at the key points where I've won, he can say I haven't. No, I have. The co-altitude is for a calculation of the GP on the parallel plane, surface level, sea level. Same thing you corrected to with your dip correction that you talked about. These are all parallel planes. Planes. Flat. You are measuring flat for the co-altitude. GP. Ground position. If it's on the ground, it's at the end of a 90-degree triangle. To your position. That's what it is. It can't be done if that line is bent.
Cool. So... we agree that the co-altitude times 60 nautical miles is the distance to the ground position?
Only possible on a flat Earth. Ergo, Earth is being measured flat. That distance is a straight, not bent line.
Mm-hmm.
So Earth is measured flat. We haven't got a curved surface between us and the GP.
So Nathan, if I can...
So Nathan isn't a yes. We haven't got a curved surface between us and the GP. Second time's a charm.
We do, actually, but...
We do? That seemed like a bit of a quiver in your voice. No, we don't. It wouldn't give you an angle. We haven't got a curved line between us and the GP because the 90-degree point would preclude you having an angle if that line was curved. You are incorrect. There is not third time's a charm with him chanting straight through the middle of me. Third time's a charm with you thinking that you're going to get away from this point. You see his light flashing, audience? That's him chanting through the top of me. Now, mate, I've got a show. I've dealt with thousands of people like you that think they can chant through the top. I just close your line when you do it so the audience doesn't have to tolerate your attempted obfuscation of the fact that it won't be a 90-degree angle at the GP if it's a curved line meeting it. Third time's a charm.
Mm.
The word you're looking for is yes. That's correct. It cannot be a curved line or it would not be an angle.
It's a curved line. And
no, it won't be an angle. It won't have 90. You can't have 90 degrees on a curved line. Definitely not. It seems this guy doesn't understand what angles are. Angles require straight lines, son. Do you not know what an angle is? Are you stupid? Do you think a curved line meeting a straight line will give you a 90 degree? What kind of idiot are you?
Angles just require lines.
Sorry, is that someone else chanting in because I've won and demolished this idiot with him saying that a curved line meeting a... What, perpendicular to a curved line, the GP is straight down. Yeah, it's running vertically to the ground position, and you're measuring 90 degrees from your position. That cannot be curved, or it wouldn't be 90. That's the fourth attempt.
Where does 60 to a vertex being like an angle being a vertex? Well, an angle is a vertex, but not all vertexes are angles. That's wrong.
Yeah, straight lines. You need straight lines for angles. You keep saying you can have a curved line to give you 90. No, a curved line won't give you a 90-degree angle. That's straight lines that must be meeting it, and they're coming from your position to the ground position. A ground position is very specifically 90 degrees. If you're saying the point on the ground meeting it is curving, it isn't 90 degrees anymore. That's the fifth attempt.
If I have two distances from the ground position, that say one is 10 miles, one is 20 miles... Why doesn't that line up with the same triangle? So the 10-mile triangle and the 20-mile triangle don't have the same height.
Sorry, he didn't acknowledge. He's now taken it to the non-sequitur of measuring the heights of the stars in the most ham-handed, pathetic way possible.
Okay.
Meanwhile, while he now starts chanting the fact that I'm pointing out his non-sequitur fallacy about measuring heights of stars, I'm going to point out that I made five attempts for him to concede his logical fallacy in assertion that you can have a curved line meeting 90. No, straight lines meet 90, and now he's into la-la land talking about heights. Flailing. Because he cannot, after six attempts, concede that you can't have a 90 degree at a GP position, that's ground position, it's on the ground, if the line meeting it is curved. I've made seven attempts, and you think, what, we're going to talk about heights, because you can't concede, you pathetic coward. It's a straight line meeting it at 90. Eight attempts.
Can he take us to the problem?
You may respond. It cannot be curved, as you asserted. You were incorrect. To be a 90-degree ground
position.
We have
60 nautical miles.
Maybe if he chants through the summary of the thing that he's got to concede, he won't have to listen to it. Yeah, I'll shut that shit down straight away. I'll try again for a 10th time, because you chanted through the 9th attempt. You're silence after the 8th. So I'll try a 10th. Maybe if I tell you that I'm going to make a 10th attempt, you'll start chanting immediately like the fundamentalist.
It is not a triangle.
Sell it. Prove my point as I do it while you flail for my audience and they pay me to watch you do it. You're flailing. You know damn well it can't have a curved line meeting a ground position at 90 degrees, because 90 degrees would have two straight lines, proving Earth's measured flat for the baseline. Thousands of miles in all directions, you've got ground positions to stars, all on a flat Earth. Now he says it's curved and starts asking me about the heights. I've made 10 attempts for him to concede his error. Can't have curved lines meeting 90. That's 11 attempts, you pathetic globe-believing weasel. Do you like Flat Earther laughing at you as you flail? Because that's what's happening, son. Kind of a curved line, meet at 90 at the ground position. You're wrong.
Describe me a triangle that for
every... That's non-sequitur. He's now asking and demanding that I do something for him. I've made clear his error's been corrected. Curved lines won't meet 90-degree ground positions. So he's making demands of things that I should address. That's 12 attempts, mate. Do you think your pathetic attempt to flail away from this is anything more than amusement for my audience? I'll repeat it a 13th time if you need me to. You can't have a curved line, as you asserted, meeting a 90-degree ground position. 90 degrees is two straight lines, one of which is the ground, the baseline, meeting it at 90, thousands of miles away for all the different stars on the ground at 90 on a flat Earth. You said the ground position could have a curved line meeting it. You were wrong, and I've made 14 attempts to correct a fundamentalist religious zealot who cannot accept that Earth is being measured flat. I took my victory about 10 minutes ago. You, having told me that I didn't win, have made, what, 13 excellent rebuttals? Because I've now asked you 14 times the same thing and I haven't got a response to it. Curved line won't meet 90, mate. You're wrong. Earth isn't a sphere. Earth's measured
triangles
flat.
Triangles that increase...
How does presupposing...
Shut Brenda up. She's not going to white knight for this asshole. 14 times I've asked him and I'm going to get a response or he's going to run away. That's his only two options. Not white knighting.
Well, I don't think he's heard a word you said, yeah, because I've had him server muted, and every time I unmute him, he's still speaking and rambling in the background. So
oh, okay. No, cool. Thank you for clarifying
that. Server muted.
Okay, so when I'm assuming that I've actually got a bit of clear air for him to hear my actual claim put to him 14 times, what he's doing, like he's like, they're all one-trick ponies. What they do, right, literally, what they do is they stick their fingers in their ears and go, la 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 la, so that they don't have to listen. That is what they do, so that if they don't hear the fact that a curved line can't meet a ground position at 90 degrees, they won't have to respond to it. And they think that if they've talked the entire time, the rest of the panel who are around them in Discord won't have heard what I've put to him, so they won't back him up or back me up in support when he doesn't respond to it. It doesn't seem to the people in Discord like anything's wrong. He's got nothing to respond to because they haven't heard it either. Yeah, this trick has been employed for about the last 7 years. I mean, it is so pathetic. All it shows my audience is that rather than addressing the fact that 90 degrees to a baseline from your position along a flat Earth being measured with an elevation angle cannot be done with a curved line as he asserted. As long as that's the last point he dropped into the conversation and doesn't hear any response, he will, what, delude himself that he's won? No, Earth's measured flat, mate. No amount of sticking your fingers in your ears and talking incessantly when I point that out 15 times will get you away from that fact. And no amount of Brenda coming along to save you will help you either. It just shows my audience how badly you globe believers have lost when we measure Earth flat. And we do. All you can do in response is tell us, no, it's a curved baseline. No, it isn't. 16 attempts later, the coward has got to either be... He's created a new option. It's not either respond or run away. It's never hear the claim in rebuttal or get removed. He's made two new options that are much easier to stomach for him. How quaint.
Well, he's whinging in the chat, so we'll give him one more chance and see how he goes.
Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, John. We'll reintroduce you back into it. I know I took the reins off you.
Yeah, I was just going to bring it back on topic because when he raised his phone up, that was with respect to horizontal. His description when he was trying to talk about a gas pressure gradient in an upwards vector required horizontal boundary layers. He is now into using a flat Earth to try to prove a sky vacuum. It's not an easy place to cognitively exist.
Yeah, and anything that adds to the cognitive load will just be chanted through. I can't cope with another thing on top of all the stuff I'm currently dealing with. I'm trying to prove a sky vacuum with a phone that's lifting with respect to sea level and flat Earth proving elevations. And then he's telling me about my example that I definitely didn't want to go off topic with when I brought it up and proved a flat Earth with it, because curved lines can meet a 90 degree angle. That's where we're at. We can't cope with that. It's too much. All at once.
It is. That would be rough. You know, because you're not only destroying his worldview, you're destroying his world now, too.
Yeah, it's, bless.
It's not easy.
Yeah, I bet he thought he was coming here to tell us how stupid we were. He thought we were going to be the ones getting educated by him, didn't he? What a shock.
He's destroying
it. Give him a chance to answer the question.
Yes, I'll just get control of my G+. Yes, okay, right. The guy's going to now pipe up again. We'll see how
How long have I got before I get muted again?
Well, it depends on whether
Am I good to go, AJ? Go off onto a tangent.
Well, it just depends whether you answer the question or you run off onto another tangent.
Okay, fair enough. So I don't feel destroyed, I'll tell you that. So, are we sticking on the celestial navigation topic, or are we going to go back to gas?
It to you that you can't have your assertion of a curved line meeting a 90-degree ground position. It must require a flat Earth baseline between you and the 90-degree ground position for you measuring any star out along a horizontal plane of reference. See, while I was explaining this, you had your mic wide open. It didn't seem like you wanted to listen. I'll try that again, hopefully with your mic closed of your own volition, rather than the server operators having to do it because you can't tolerate what I've said. I'll repeat it a second time. The way we left off when you started chanting through 15 attempts of me trying to explain that your assertion we can have a curved line meeting a ground position at 90 degrees is garbage and wrong. I was attempting to correct you. I took 15 attempts with you chanting through me. So now that we've got you under control, maybe you can cope with an answer when I put it to you now, that you are incorrect when you say a curved line can meet a position that is specifically 90 degrees, therefore requires a flat baseline to be meeting it, and that's a flat Earth that's being measured. I'd like you to acknowledge that. Before we move on to anything else, furthermore, there is a little caveat. Once you acknowledge that there won't be a curved line meeting a 90 degree anything ever, I'll bask in victory and then we'll move on, just so we're clear what's going to happen. You may respond to the 90 degree not bent line that you can't have as you declared.
Okay, so thank you very much. I feel undefeated, but I think you're wrong, Nathan, that my understanding of the geometry is that the 60 degrees per nautical mile is the pivotal thing here, right? That's the property of a sphere. And there is flat plane geometry that will align.
That's incorrect. Do you want to keep going? You were wrong again. Miles derived. No, he's not going to tolerate it. You were wrong, but no, you won't stand the correction. You just ascribed distances in miles nautical to a globe. No, they're derived off a flat plane. They're with respect to the angle measurements to Polaris off a flat plane. You were just incorrect. You thought they were globe related. They're not. They're flat Earth measurements. They're straight line distances for one. I'm still correcting you, dumbass. You think you're educating me when I'm correcting you when you were wrong and ascribe a flat straight? Maybe you'll get muted by one of the server operators because now it's painful. Because I'm pointing out that flat straight line distances, that's miles, cannot be spherical. There's flat straight line distances for one. Secondly, the derivation of that actual number for nautical miles comes from a flat angle measurement with 90 degrees to Polaris. Same argument we're having that you can't have a curved line meeting Polaris because we're deriving the angles in recession to the horizon to give you this nautical mile distance on a flat plane. It's a straight flat mile measurement distance, not in relation to a sphere distance. You were wrong when you said that. That's why I stopped you. Now, I doubt for 1 second that he hasn't babbled through the fact that he's had to be server muted while I corrected his dumbass about straight, flat distances that he ascribed to a globe incorrectly.
I love how you got mad at him for interrupting you when you interrupted him.
Is that a white knight helping him out while I point out that miles are a straight, flat distance derived from Polaris measurements with angles with 90 degree below Polaris? Maybe a white knight needs to tell me about my attitude when I win and prove how Earth's measured flat. I'll just mute that line when some asshole decides that they're going to rumpus the fact that we win. The flat earthers are perfectly righteous in berating your stupidity because you didn't know any of this stuff. In fact, you lie, the other guy did, had to lie, about having a curved line meeting something that's specifically defined as having a 90-degree angle. He said curved line meet. He still hasn't conceded it. What he did do is make the bold-faced assertion that he hadn't lost rather than conceding the fact that 90 will never have a curve meeting it. That's what he actually did. Sad. A white knight's going to pipe up about how this is taking place in my attitude. Of course they will. Because we've won. Earth is measured flat with a flat baseline to a 90-degree angle below Polaris to derive these flat measurements of miles. Go ahead, John.
Yeah, the geometry does not say on a sphere. It says from inside a sphere with reference to the plane, the equatorial plane. That's how the geometry works. It is not on a sphere. It's in a sphere. So those two words, while they're really close, it's just that one letter off, and there are only two letters. So on and in are not the same thing, just like up and down are not the same as in and out.
This guy has no idea what you're talking about. When you're talking about projecting PZX triangles out from celestial planes at the center of hell, he hasn't got a clue that's how it all works. If I even attempted to educate him in his own religion, navigational he wouldn't tolerate triangle. It. And right on cue, while I'm educating him about his religion, he's right on cue, talking straight through the middle of me. Look, dumbass, we know a hell of a lot more about your stupid globe religion than you do, right? We know how those flat earth measurements that you failed to concede in 15 attempts get converted into hell to project out spherical triangles for your globe faith to have some sort of justification for flat earth measurements. Now, we know this stuff because we have an advanced understanding in your heliocentric religion. You, on the other hand, are a standard rank and file moron who feels it's always his turn to talk. You're an idiot, mate. We know better than you do. I know that might be painful given that we're flat earthers and you feel like you should be the one with righteous indignation being a globe believer and all. Well, no, mate, that is not the circumstances here. You don't know much about your religion. You just seem to profess to knowing something about celestial navigation. And then proving a flat earth proves very difficult when you want to lie about having curved surfaces meet 90 degree ground positions. They don't. You still haven't conceded that, by the way.
So, yeah, you're right. I must have some fundamental misunderstanding. So you said something about Polaris and latitude, or Polaris and 60 degrees per nautical mile, how that was derived. So can you explain that to me?
No, I'd prefer that you understand that having 90 degrees to Polaris would mean that the line that you said was bent can't be, because it won't have 90 degrees to Polaris for my explanation. Okay. So far, I'm explaining something to somebody who thinks incorrectly while he interrupts my objection to explaining this to somebody who hasn't conceded to the fact that to have 90 degrees in my explanation to Polaris to derive nautical miles with that latitude measurement, you would need to understand at a base level that we'll have a flat baseline between us and the 90 degree point of Polaris. You wouldn't concede that. So how the hell am I going to explain it to you? You think a curved line will meet 90 degree points below Polaris. How can I explain it to you unless you concede Earth is measured flat for this derivation of an angle measurement with 90 degrees below Polaris? So before we move forward with me educating you, the ignorant ball-believing clown who's very irritating and can't shut his mouth while I educate his dumbass, can you concede that we won't have a curved line meeting the 90 degree point below Polaris? And then we'll tell you our nautical miles are derived from that flat Earth measurement.
Well, I'm confused now.
We know.
Because my globe indoctrination tells me that Polaris is a very long way away, right? And for all practical purposes. All right,
what does this have to do with what I asked you to concede? So he's going to non sequitur his way away with a little story. No, mate, I'm asking you to concede something, and I need you to concede it so I can answer your previous question about how we derive nautical miles. Now you're off into la-la land about what you believe, and I don't give a crap what you believe in this religious garbage that you
call heliocentric belief. Trying to understand the angle to Polaris.
I'm asking you to concede something I've already asked you to concede 16, nay, 17 times, and you are chanting through the repetition, this, now the third, in a second attempt, in a series of 17, of me getting you to concede that we can't have a curved line meeting a 90-degree ground position below Polaris, for me to further expand on and expound on how we will derive a nautical mile measurement from that flat Earth angle along a flat baseline with 90 degrees of Polaris, because at this point you think a curved line meets that point and it doesn't. You were wrong. I've now made 18 attempts to correct that. You won't have it. You're constantly off in non sequiturs.
Well, now I'm sorry, I thought you're done.
I'll be done when I give you bleeding permission to talk rather than when you decide that I've been done because you haven't listened to a single word I said. From this point forth, you may talk when I give you permission. And if you don't yield to the fact that I'm in charge here, I'm going to ask the mods to remove you because you're really irritating me. I've made 19 attempts. Mods, just remove him. Just remove him, mods. Mods, remove him. Mods, remove him. Remove him from the call. He can't. I'm not going to do 20 attempts with him. I've just started the 19th attempt. He wouldn't allow it. So that's the end. I'm done. I'm not going to spend 19 times with a liar telling my audience a curved line can meet a 90-degree angle position at the base of a star called Polaris and then expound on how we derive nautical mile measurements from that flat Earth measurement when he is in, under the misapprehension that a curved line can meet 90 degrees. It cannot, and he will never concede to it. So why the hell should we have him even here? It's not reasonable. It's obviously irritating to me. Garbage. This is what we get. Rinse and repeat. We don't get anything new. None of you are original. We haven't had anything original from any of the globe believers thus far. What we do is get to the point where we prove a flat earth with their example, and they cannot bear to hear it. It's absolutely pathetic. Unless this guy's got a curved line meeting a 90 degree round position, he won't have a conversation with me. Sad. Right, I'm going to do a couple of shout-outs as nobody's decided to interject in that little brief silence I left intentionally. Shout-out to Jazz.
Oh, yeah, every time I try and speak.
No, it's only when I talk. See, it doesn't matter how long a protracted silence I leave. He's only here to antagonise me. So he's waiting for his opportunity to interrupt that next section that I introduce after a long invite, a protracted silence for him to talk. Nope, he wants to talk when I'm talking and only when I'm talking. Right, audience? This is really original. This isn't something we've seen many times before, is it? It's completely original. Shout out to Jardo, who gifted 10 memberships. Really appreciate the support. Thank you very much indeed. And if you picked up one of those memberships, check out the Uncut and After Show after we go live, because I will upload it once I finish recording it. Also, shout out to Roger Ledwell for hitting the super chat. He says, shout out to Virus. Why did you make me prove...
Gotta love this guy streaming in the voice chat. Hilarious.
Yeah, this is what I do for a living. This is my show. You're on a show.
Yeah, great. We're trying to have... I mean, how is...
So while this guy ties to non sequitur away from the point, Earth's been measured flat. Yeah, and he couldn't accept that fact with the 90 degree measurement to ground positions below stars that requires Earth be a flat baseline. He's going to talk about my show. Yeah, this guy. Is that all you got, fundies? Pathetic. We're all laughing at you. Flat earthers are now laughing at you for your ignorance. Hope you realize this. The tables are very much turned in 2024. You're now sad, pathetic, ranting, delusional morons chanting about things like gravity. It's really sad. Like religious zealots on the street pounding Bibles going, we have gravity! And we're all laughing at you from the sidelines. Yeah, 19 times to accept that a 90 degree must have a flat line meeting it. I love it. I absolutely love it. How pathetic you globe believers have become in 2024. A different question for any globe believers. Do you enjoy us flat earthers mocking your ignorance now? That's where we're at. We're mocking you for how stupid you are demonstrating yourselves to be before us. No, nobody's blood boiling? No? Well, that's what's happening, lads and ladies. You're all being mocked by flat earthers who know a lot more about the world than you do. Not only a lot more about the world, a lot more about your religion about the world. Your globe religion and your sky vacuum religion. We know all about it. You guys have got a cursory understanding that you got from high school. What a shock when you find out it's all garbage.
Pretty hard to have a debate. I get muted immediately for just speaking.
Was that the same guy? You can't have a curved line meeting a 90-degree ground position.
What? This is not. I don't know who you're talking about, bro. Sorry. I'm someone completely different.
Mr. Jew. This is Mr. Jew, Nathan. He's someone completely different. But the reason you are muted, Mr. Jew, is because both times when you chose to speak were right in the middle of sentences, and the last one was complaining about the show, yeah? So...
Is this the Nathan show, or is this a Flat Earth Debate channel? I don't understand.
Are you...
It's a sincere question.
I was about to answer you.
So this room is hosting Nathan here tonight and Nathan's show.
Got it. Okay. It's a sincere question, Nathan. You gotta, like, I don't understand why you're just so aggressive to people who are trying to have a conversation with you.
Would you like me to answer?
I guess. Well, kind of how conversations work, but you know what? It's your show. You do your
thing.
Now
I'm being told how conversations work. I ask, would you like an answer? I guess is the answer. I start answering. You start telling me how conversations run. What, with people immediately talking through the request for an answer and an affirmation that you definitely do want it? Maybe our conversation runs as you immediately start talking through me. This is why I'm irritated, because that's generally what's happened in 19 attempts for a zealot globe believer who told me that I can have a curved line meeting a 90-degree position on the ground. I told him 19 times. Now, I doubt you heard that rebuttal once, because what he did was talk like you're now talking, straight through the top of me. And that's really irritating. What? And because you're doing it, I'm going to call you names. Yeah? If I'm of
you
that inclination.
Wanker.
Yeah, that kind of name.
How am I talking through you?
Well, I'm talking and you've decided to talk as I talk. That's talking through me. Meanwhile, the guy didn't respond in 19 attempts to his incorrect assertion that you can have a curved line meeting a 90-degree point.
Move on to a different subject.
And it would
subject.
Seem that while I'm pointing it out to this guy and I had the line closed, he started talking while I pointed it out to him. Isn't that interesting, audience?
Yeah, because you've said it four times now. I'm asking if you can change the subject. Talk
no.
about something else. The guy's muted.
Okay, I'll answer you. I'll answer you. Let me answer
twat.
You. Can everyone else who's
fucking
not him
twat.
Please be muted? No, the answer to your question is, can we change the subject from a flat Earth elevation angle measurement proving we measure Earth flat?
That's been, except that's not what you're talking about. You're just
it
going on and on about
now,
your 90.
He doesn't know how to have a conversation. I don't want this to continue. Please, can you stop this guy from talking to me? Thank you. Yeah, I'm in charge, mate, and I'm just going to appeal to the mods because you're a wanker to shut you up. Yeah. No.
Bloody wanker.
He is, yeah. Anyway, so
right.
I pointed out to another guy 19 times, and now this guy 5 times before he had to be server muted because he wanted to change the subject. It was painful. He asked if he could have a subject change. I was responding, no, I'm going to keep proving that Earth's measured flat, because all of the mapping systems and indeed globe beliefs are derived from these flat Earth measurements. These angle measurements off a flat baseline with 90 degrees below Polaris gives us our latitude system that gets stretched around a globe after measuring it flat. So your globe belief is reliant on these measurements. So when you ask if we can change the subject from the origins of your globe belief, that would be measurements of a flat Earth with Polaris at the centre, I'm going to go with no. I'm going to go with I will prove to my audience over and over again just how Earth is measured flat and how that flat Earth measurement is used for you to believe in a globe that comes from those measurements. A calculated globe that you reify into existence with sky vacuums around it in violation of natural laws. That's what I'll do. When you ask me if we can change the subject, the answer will be no. Hope that answers his question.
Nathan, imagine him believing you live on a globe and then you eventually find out that the globe that you think you live on is flat and it's measured like that. How bizarre.
I'd want to change the subject too.
I get excited when they say, can we have a conversation change? It's like, really? This is how painful it is? Keep going.
Yeah. Don't want to talk about how flat it's measured, do they?
No.
No. Don't want that.
Even if we're telling them how their globe came from those measurements, they still don't want to hear it. I mean, we try and give them a higher level of understanding when it comes to their globe religion, and they don't want to hear it. We're like, no, you've got latitude lines around your stupid globe. Where do you think they came from? Do you think they were measured on that globe? Nah, they were measured on a flat plane with angles to Polaris. That's how all the maps were derived. That's why they're all flat, so you can still functionally use them with angles off a flat Earth. Did you never wonder why all the maps were flat? What's that? You think they were globe projections? Oh, did they not tell you that the latitude on the globe came from flat Earth measurements before that? Oh, they just didn't tell you. Oh, well, that makes you dumb. And I, the flat earther, know better than you about your stupid globe faith. This must be very painful. You'd want to change the subject from the flat Earth measurements that you need for your globe. Surely you'd want to know more about how your globe came to be. Oh, you don't. You'd rather just believe in it as a fantasy, and I'm ruining that for you. Oh, that's a shame. Well, what I'm doing is laughing at you and mocking you because you're all stupid globe-believing numpties who don't really know any better. And I, with righteous indignation as a flat earther, do. I and everybody around here who is a flat earther right now are factually smarter than every single globe believer in this server. We are your superiors, intellectually speaking. You are all dumbos who chant through us and need 19 repetitions of your failures. That's how it actually took place here today. Hope we're all clear on the globe side just how dumb you all are and how we are mocking you now. Us, the flat earthers, well, are so mocking rude. You.
I'll accept the dumb thing, but watch who you're calling a numptier.
Numpty means dumb.
You should check your dictionary, friend. It certainly does not.
Oh, maybe I'll be standing corrected after I look it up. Meanwhile, intellectual superiority from flat earthers was what I was highlighting more than anything here. Specifically with regards to globe understanding.
Great globe proof, mate.
We were pointing out that we know more about your stupid globe religion than you do. And that's embarrassing and painful.
Can I have...
Can
I have an example...
Go ahead, sorry.
...of three circles being drawn on a map?
Sorry,
Nathan, for Top Hat in the chat. At 40 minutes past the hour from Oxford Dictionary, numpty, noun, informal, British, a stupid or ineffectual person. Confused numpties who have little idea of what they are talking about is the example given.
Thank you.
Maybe colloquial. Yeah.
So again, yet again, a flat earther correcting the phraseology was corrected by a globe-believing idiot saying they were wrong and they needed to look it up. The person who said that, just so we're clear, you just made a perfect example of how the flat earther, in this case me, was your intellectual superior in phraseology and linguistic ability. I knew better and used the word correctly because that guy was an idiot, a numpty, stupid. He didn't know much about his globe religion and how the origins worked. And now, in response to me taking my victory of intellectual superiority, somebody else is chanting through me. Probably somebody stupid. Probably a globe believer. All right, are you a stupid globe believer, the guy that just started talking?
And I heard you stutter there. That's what I heard. And you are kind of dumb, because you think that's...
What a wanker. So immediately into an ad hom. I say, no curved line to a 90-degree earth-measured flat. He starts talking about how I'm stuttering straight into the ad hom. That's a logical fallacy.
Well, are ad homs bad, Nathan?
Yeah, the logical fallacies. Wow! The globe believer asks if fallacious reasoning is bad. Oh, no! Fallacious reasoning is wonderful, mate! You stupid globe-believing numpty! Hello? The guy who asked me if fallacious reasoning was bad. Do you feel smart? Because we are now with righteous indignation mocking you for your demonstrated stupidity. So the audience is clear. I've now got to clear this up as the flat earther with intellectual superiority. That's right, audience. Using fallacious reasoning like an ad hominem attack is bad. This dumb globe believer didn't quite realise that. Fairly standard fare that me, the flat earther, has to correct an idiot globe believer when he declares, in an expressed high tone, is it bad to use a logical fallacy? Yeah, it is, you stupid idiot. You numpty.
Yeah, so that was Rich Evans, yeah? So, Rich, have you got anything else to contribute to the conversation, or...?
I could, yeah. Am I going to be able to speak, or am I going to get...
Well, it depends if you just
chanted over,
or you're going to stay on top.
You're going to get chanted over.
What did you want to talk about, AJ?
Anything in regards to...
Come on, Rich, prove the globe.
Everyone else, please be quiet.
I think we'll stick on Nathan's topic, yeah? Is an angle two straight lines meeting at a vertex?
If we're sticking to Nathan's topic, then we're going to be talking about how we're not dumb, right?
No.
You can demonstrate.
Because that's all he was talking about.
Okay, I'll pick up the reins from there.
I was trying to clarify it for you, and you just spoke straight through me.
Yeah, I'll pick up the reins from there if you want me to. He's saying
he's
going to talk about how dumb they're not. Okay, well, that's by way of demonstration. So my examples thus far with people's stupidity have been with stupidity like curved lines meeting at vertices to create 90s. That's stupid. So I give examples where my opponent, a globe believer in this instance, is stupid. So I can call him a stupid globe believer because as a globe believer, he's declared that a curved line can meet a 90 degree point on the ground. It can't. That makes him stupid. And the reason for his stupidity is his globe belief. Therefore, I am righteous in declaring him as such because it's absolutely factually accurate. Now, I don't know you. I don't know if you're going to use fallacy. We'll see how we get on. But when we measure Earth flat with 90 degree points to Polaris, what we're actually just doing is taking an angle to a star with respect to a horizontal plane that we are standing on and establishing that we can get 90 below the star at something called a ground position. 90 degrees between that point and you is a flat Earth. So with that example, I proved that Earth is measured flat. It was actually my opponent's example. I didn't bring it up.
Sorry, was that drivel supposed to mean something?
Yeah, it means we measure Earth flat. It wasn't drivel. It was a quite concise description of an elevation angle measurement to Polaris with 90 degrees below it called the ground position and a line along the ground between you and it. A baseline.
I can't differentiate
with
that
respect
but
to a horizontal
and,
plane.
Mushy peas
and it
coming
seems
in.
That if it's not just drivel that he didn't understand, perhaps where a good chunk of my audience absolutely understood what I just said, you project your ignorance because you failed to understand it? Because it wasn't drivel. It was a concise description of an elevation angle measurement. That particular concise description that you interrupted after calling drivel is actually our system called latitude. You called it drivel. It's actually called latitude. Your ignorance, demonstrated stupidity here, led you to ascribe a description of measuring latitude. You labelled it drivel because you are an ignorant globe believer like the last guy. It's not drivel, it's called a latitude measurement. I hope you feel educated by me, the flat earther, who's now mocking you for your ignorance. So, yeah, I stand by my example. We are smarter than you globe-believing numpties. That was just demonstrated by that guy. Thanks for making my example for me and justifying me laughing at you. Maybe you'd like to tell me that I stuttered through my example where I proved Earth's measured flat. Maybe. We'll see.
No, he's taken off.
I thought.
Run away, little globe believer.
Nathan, it was dribbled
we'll give
to
Gregory
him
another chance.
Because he can't comprehend it.
Yeah, he projected that.
But it's perfectly sound English to me.
I did say that. I said he projected his ignorance, but yes, that's correct. Go ahead, AJ. I'm sorry.
Well, good. I'm just saying I've unmuted Gregory. We'll give Gregory another chance. He was speaking originally before Rich rudely interrupted and took over and then bolted.
Yeah. I mean, I just want to ask Nathan, can a gradient extend to 10 to the negative 17 tor in a container?
What claim did I make about this exactly?
You say that you can't go to a place that's 10 to the negative 17 tor vacuum of outer space.
Yeah, gas would fill that area of volume. I gave a Yale example where a university lecturer explained how gas fills a volume, and the volume would be space, so gas would fill it, as per the Yale example I played. Did you hear the Yale example
so
where he described gas dispersion into a volume? Did you hear that example get played? I could play it again.
Well, I'm curious then. How low does pressure have to get?
You don't seem to be responding through me. You seem to be responding at the middle of my conclusion and question of you. I'll try that again for a second time. Hopefully you won't chant through the middle of me. We'll see how I get on. I'll try a second time. Did you hear the Yale lecture about specifically PV equals NRT and the second law of thermodynamics with a very specific example of gas filling a volume? Gas fills...
Yeah, I heard you say that.
There's the conclusion again that he's rumpus. That's the second attempt. Are you a
coward? I said I
coward?
Heard that, retard.
Are you a coward? Do you need to chant through the end of my statement there, coward? Is it that you're scared of me and the answers to the question won't be forthcoming? Therefore, if you chant through the end of the question, you won't have to answer it? Scared? Shall I try a third time, little boy? Are you a small boy?
Yeah, I said I heard that.
Are you a small boy?
I said I heard that.
Are you a small boy?
Are you an old man? Are you an old man?
Yeah, I am.
Yeah. I mean,
meanwhile, gas-filled space. The Yale lecturer made that absolutely clear, and I'm trying to get clarity, third time's the charm. With this guy, if he heard the Yale lecturer describe gas-filling space when describing the second law of thermodynamics, did you hear that is my question. It's a yes or no question. Closed.
For the third time, Nathan, I heard that. Do you understand English, Nathan?
Yeah, gas-filled space. It's like a genie that gets out of the perfume bottle. You'll never get it back in. So gas that we're all breathing fills space. So space is fake. We wouldn't have high-pressure gas. We wouldn't be breathing it if there was an availability of volume for it to fill that it ain't filling in your religion.
All right, so how low does pressure have to get before you require a container, Nathan?
I'm not making claims about anything to do with the sky. This is a sky vacuum claim for you to have an outer space. I'm responding to you, and you don't seem to like my response. It seems like my response is painful and needs immediate chanting.
A bit retarded.
Oh, another triggered fundy, ladies and gentlemen. He doesn't like my responses. It's much easier if the question he asks is followed immediately by him carrying on talking. The answers don't want to be heard, again, like the last guy. This is why we mock you, because you seem weak. Yeah, I'm trying to respond to you. You're asking me about why gases do things. Did I have a claim about something in regards to this? Or was it just my rebuttal in regards to you having a sky vacuum belief that defies entropy? Because I don't remember making any positive assertions in this regard. But if we're done with my rebuttal about gas filling space and my example of the Yale University professor specifically detailing our gas-filled space, then that's it. That's the end of the discussion about your sky vacuum in the affirmative positive claim that's been refuted. What's that? Did you want to ask me something about the sky? I don't really have any claims about that, so I don't feel the need to defend anything. But did you need to ask me about how gas behaves? You, like I, could sit through hours and hours of Yale University lectures, like I've done. Or what's the other one I sat through? MIT. Hours and hours of lectures that I've sat through. From MIT and Yale about second law and first law. Man, it's boring and tedious. You can do that too if you want to know how this stuff works. I just use it to absolutely take a giant steaming shit on stupid globe-believing numpty's belief that the sky is a vacuum. Beyond that, I don't have any positive claims to have to answer your questions in that regard. I hope you understand.
You have somebody
it's more like
to
you
the
can't respond
to
because you don't actually know what you're...
Was that the start of an ad hum? You don't know what you're talking about. No, I cited Yale. The audience heard it and you heard it. Do I not know what I'm talking about? What about the guy from Yale? He's talking about gas filling space. It's a law of nature. You don't know what you're talking about. Again, a nice, beautiful example for my audience where we, the flat earthers, righteous indignation. You stupid boy. Sit down. You obviously haven't sat through any of these lectures and want to tell me how I don't understand. Yeah, I do. Anything else, son? Or can we start mocking you for your stupidity and lack of understanding?
You run away. That's fine. Run away.
Now, I'm asking you if there's anything else beyond your lack of understanding of the second law of thermodynamics.
I've already proved you don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, it was the same ad hom that we laughed at last time, showing your weakness. I pointed out to my audience how weak that makes you seem. You feel the need to rinse and repeat that weak-ass crap about how I don't understand the many hours of lectures on thermodynamic laws that I've watched. No, I understand. I absolutely assure you. Is that all you've got, or was there anything else? Maybe you wanted to accuse me again of running away when I'm running a live show.
Well, I mean, I'll give you a second shot, Nathan. So you're saying that gas pressure can't go to 10 to the negative 17 torr as the gradient, right? Because it will fill the available space.
I didn't
space.
Say that.
So
I did not
is
say
65
that.
Miles?
He's just told me what I'm saying, and I didn't say that. I didn't say that, and he won't shut up. So you've got to put a false quote in my mouth that I didn't say. Is that really how you work? Oh, sir, no, unless you can rattle off a verbatim quote where I say that gas cannot fill 10 to the minus 17 torr. Those words never cross my lips. You're just lying about things I haven't said. Again, we've had thousands of examples of lying glurfs who need to insert words I haven't said into my mouth with the words, so you are saying, insert bullshit I've never, ever uttered here, and then start responding to that crap that I've never said. No, I've never said that gas won't fill 10 to the minus 17 torr, quite the opposite. I say gas fills space. That's what I actually say. Maybe you need something else that I haven't said to respond to. Sad.
So, Nathan.
Is this someone else?
Are you... are you able to demonstrate...
Did you want to appeal to the moderator before you just pick up the baton in some server? I was talking to someone else. You just lost badly. Do you think it's your chance to take my victory dance away from me? How dare you? That guy just had his ass absolutely handed to him. Yeah? By me, a flat earther. Another example justifying why I'm mocking you globe believers for being stupid. That was another example of that. And my righteous indignation in telling you to shut up while I take my little victory dance as a flat earther with the intellectual superiority I've demonstrated here in front of a load of globe-believing numpties who don't really know much about their own stupid religion of a sky vacuum-based globe that's based on flat earth measurements. That was my victory dance, son. Now you can appeal to one of the mods and ask him permission to talk.
All right, yeah. AJ, I would like to ask Nathan a question.
Yeah, man, I think we're done with Jekyll. Or Gregory. Sorry, Gregory. Jekyll. Yep, go ahead, trigonometry man.
All right. Do you have a demonstration of gas pressure in a container having a gradient?
Bottle garden, why are you asking me? I don't have a positive claim about this. I just explained this to the last guy. I'm now answering him, and within seconds, he's talking through me. Shocking, isn't it? Weak. Meanwhile, I'll just conclude. I hadn't really started. I gave you an example, bottle garden. Shut your stupid mouth. Meanwhile, I don't know why I'm being asked for this example that's in absolute congruence with every single example of any gas pressure or gas pressure gradient ever, because they'll all have containment without exception. Meanwhile, this doesn't need to be put at my door. I am not claiming anything about the sky. The reason we point out the second law of thermodynamics is because you have a positive claim that the sky is a vacuum if you're a Western world globe believer. I don't have any claim in this regard, and I only explained this to the last guy 2 minutes ago.
Well, you do make a claim that a container is required, correct?
It's an antecedent, consequent relationship. Unless you can demonstrate that you don't need a container for gas pressure, meaning it's pressing, or you can cite something beyond NASA, who say that pressure is the force exerted on the walls of the container. No, that's not a positive claim. It's an antecedent consequent relationship.
You so hate stupid people, Nathan.
There's somebody else with a nice little ad hom. White Knight ad homs from sideline when someone gets a proper pasting and pummeling. We're still not addressing the fact that this isn't a positive claim I need to defend. I've put that to him. He hasn't responded to it. Well, chances of him actually responding to something I say without total interruption, Fundy muting like he's doing now. You know, my points don't get addressed. I pointed out that I've put it to him and the last guy within 5 minutes. Will it get addressed? No, of course not. I'm not making a positive claim about what the sky is. Second time.
Can I address it?
And just before we move forward, I would not appeal to gas pressure gradients with respect to sea level as a defense for it. You see what happened to the last guy?
Yeah. Pressure gradients.
Nathan hates stupid people.
Pressure gradients are described with respect to sea level. Altitude of the gradient is a description that requires a flat earth to describe it. So yeah, that won't go well if he appeals to that. Roger Ledwell, shout out to you for the super chat. We're going to run for about maybe 5 more minutes live. All the islands in oceans, all the heavens in the motions. Okay. Thank you for the super chat.
So
would you say PMARS is the best debater?
No.
If we have a gas pressure lower, and then you're using the example of the Yale lecture, what causes the gas pressure lower to not fill the available space up higher if it's lower pressure?
You're asking me why doesn't the gas in your heliocentric religion fill space? Is that what you're asking me?
No, I'm asking why doesn't the gas fill the area in the flat earth space? Why doesn't, if gas fills the available space, then what's stopping the gas at lower altitudes
I don't get it. Why are you saying if second law of thermodynamics? Sorry, if law of nature? No, let's just start there. That was your first statement. If gas fills space, what are you babbling about? Gas fills space.
Yeah, if.
It should stop.
If.
Stop. Not if. So when I say not if 3 times, his first statement that he interrupts me with is if. No, gas fills space. It is not an if, but contrary to if, a law of nature. That means it occurs always. So we're not going to start this discussion with if gas fills space, because it's not an if, it's a law of friggin' nature. So, based on the fact that you're prefacing your question to me about how gas behaves with an if gas fills space, I'm not going to be able to answer it. We need to first deal with your misunderstandings of laws of nature, things that occur always. By correcting your putting it into a question with an if, maybe it won't happen. No, it's not an if. Are we clear?
All right, yep. So it always happens. So because it always happens, why does the gas not fill the available space? Why is there a gradient?
It does! Is he stupid? It's just said, gas fills space, so why doesn't gas fill space? Are you fundamentally idiotic? You've said, yeah, I understand, it's a law of nature, yeah, gas fills space. So I'm going to put it to you, why doesn't gas fill the volume? You're asking me why gas doesn't do that which it does, you stupid clown. Are you mentally retarded? You've just accepted the premise that gas always fills space and ask me why it doesn't fill volumes. What, space?
Yeah,
it does.
Why does it?
Are you deaf and stupid? It does fill space. You just admitted to that. It's a law of friggin' nature. But you're going to follow on from concession of a law of nature by asking me why it doesn't do that. It does do that always. It's a law of nature. Gas fills space. So the next question, why isn't it filling a volume? What are you talking about? That does not happen. That defies the law of nature. Why are you asking me why gas defies the law of nature that you just conceded to? That makes no sense.
Wait, so you're saying that the law of gas, which is that it fills the available space, defies
the law of gas. Is that a quote? Is this a quote? Is this a quote? Is this a quote?
Wow, look at this. Yes, it is.
It's just said, so you are saying. If the next thing you say doesn't have frigging quote marks around it, I'm going to get real pissed with you real quick. Because if you do that to me, I can do that to you. I can say, so you are saying, and then insert some vulgar filth about you that you didn't really say. So don't start your sentence with, so you are saying, if the next thing out of your mouth isn't a bleeding quote.
You did say it, Nathan.
Quote.
You can't explain the gradient.
Quote.
You say gas.
What's the quote? What's the quote? If you're going to tell me what I've said, I expect you to put it in quotes. I just said that. Hello?
Quote, gas fills the available space around it.
Therefore, space is debunked. Because if the available space around us were the sky vacuum, then gas would fill it and we'd all be dead.
Therefore, gradient debunked, Nathan.
Sorry, that's a delta of gas pressure that you first need containment. So just rinse and repeat assholes today. We've already dealt with Delta X with the other guy who had demanded that he didn't do it when he did it twice, appealing to an airplane wing in existing gas pressure. And now you're appealing to a gradient within existing gas pressure. Well, if the sky was a vacuum, we wouldn't have existing gas pressure to develop a gas pressure gradient. You're appealing to Delta X. It's absolutely pathetic. Have you not got anything else other than appealing to a question about something that occurs in already in existent gas, therefore must have containment, or it would be filling the sky vacuum? Because that doesn't overcome the argument, you clown.
You're using circular reasoning, Nathan.
Now, I'm using the second law of thermodynamics and the descriptions of entropic law and gas dispersion into volumes. It's not circular reasoning, it's a law of nature.
So if it fills containers, then why doesn't it fill the container?
But what? If it fills containers, is his only prong of attack. If the guy at Yale, when he dictated to a whole bunch of people and comported with every single lecture on the second law of thermodynamics, if... No, mate, it seems like you don't want to agree with the laws of thermodynamics because it means you can't have a fundamentalist religious belief in a sky vacuum and need to reposition a law of nature into an if statement. I've dealt with this three times with you now, and I'm done, because he's no longer, for the audience's benefit, he's no longer listening to what I say. He's now continually chanting through the top of me rather than listening to what I've just said. So I don't want to talk to him anymore. Remove him, please.
Pardon me. I would like to point out that the only response contextually is to say, when challenging them about their heliocentric space, is to say, well, what about these flat earth gas pressure gradients from a level horizontal plane we call sea level? What about those? You can't explain that. Why would we need to explain a gradient from sea level? Exactly. Part of the flat earth. We don't have to explain anything to you at that point. You've accepted it's flat.
As soon as they describe pressure gradients, I'm going to have to get into the habit of doing that, John. But thank you. That was the perfect round out. Thank you to Dazza888 also. It says, fill the available volume. One of my super chatters, for the benefit of those who may not realize in Discord, the intellectually inferior globe believers, one of my super chatters has just given me $2 to quote MIT when they describe gas behavior. I'll repeat his super chat that he paid to get on air. Fill the available volume. That's what gas does. It's a law of nature. It's called the second law of thermodynamics. That was an MIT lecture on the same subject. Meanwhile, we've got to ask me a question about if second law of thermodynamics. I'm thinking no. But with that, I'm going to say, if you are watching this on either Nathan Oakley 1980 or Nathan Oakley premiering streams, then stay tuned, as there will be an after show to follow.
Find a location, please.
How do people navigate if they don't know the shape of the Earth?
Can we have an example of how we get an elevation angle using the curved surface of Earth? Because you can't have that. It's impossible.
We do know, flat. To answer P. Miles, we do know the shape of the Earth. We measure it with Polaris to get the latitude grid. We measure it flat. I mean, that's not a shape, it's an aspect. But nevertheless, the way we measure Earth is flat to get the latitude angle measurements with respect to the plane that you measure from. That would be a flat Earth. So we do know. Also, just so you're aware, P. Miles, the globe was created with those measurements. Did you know that?
The globe is flat?
Yeah, essentially, the globe was created from flat Earth measurements of angles to Polaris off a flat baseline and then stretched around a spherical surface. So yeah, the globe is measured flat in the most literal terms. Yes.
That's fascinating.
And the Greeks all knew that.
That's correct.
I can prove Christianity is true objectively.
It's not what we're debating here. You're in the wrong room.
You should believe in Jesus.
I do believe in Jesus. It's not a belief. He's well documented. From a historical standard, there's plenty of evidence to show his existence. Meanwhile, that's not what we debate here. Do you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, P. Mars?
Yeah, I became a Christian.
Good for you.
I've been debating atheist scum.
Oh, really? Well, that's a bit of a turnip. Are you still a baller?
Yeah. Yeah.
But your ball was measured off a flat plane.
How do you reconcile that?
Well, he's only found out today that his ball was measured with respect to latitude positions that are stretched around a spherical surface, but the actual measurements are circles of equal elevation, i.e. a line between you and the base of Polaris and an angle to it. So you've got a flat line along the ground to Polaris, and as you back away from it, Polaris goes towards the horizon like it drops. Well, those angle measurements, I know you can't see, but on screen for my audience now, straight long line along the ground, baseline, and then perpendicular to that at the base of Polaris, you've got its ground position at 90 degrees to your position. Well, that's how all latitude lines are measured, flat. And then you take those flat measurements and stretch them around a ball to give you the heliocentric version so that they'll back engineer with actual angle measurements off a flat Earth. That's how it all works, P. We only figured this out in the last couple of years and you haven't been here since then. So now you know, the globe came from flat Earth measurements and that's how all the maps are made. Whenever you see latitude and longitude, those rely on Earth being flat to measure them.
It can only be measured that way.
Yeah, they're all their angles, aren't they? The last guy said we can have curved lines meeting 90 degrees below Polaris. No, we can't. It doesn't work. You have to put it in the centre of hell, those flat Earth angle measurements, and then project them up and out onto the surface of a globe wrapped around where the surface is measured in the equatorial plane in hell. If you want to believe this is done with respect to a globe, you take the angle measurements to hell to do it. Who's taking angles in hell? Nobody. What is the hell in the diagram? Well, it's a flat plane extending out from the center of Earth out infinitely, called the equatorial plane, where these angles will work, the ones on screen for my audience now. But that's how the globe came into existence, with these flat Earth angle measurements to stars. Amazing, isn't it?
But isn't that pre-assuming that Earth is a globe? If you're saying you're taking measurements from the center of the Earth?
No, you first take measurements from a flat surface. They're still the same angles, but then you transpose them with a justification that all the light's coming in parallel from a very far distance. Therefore, it's all cushy to put it in the center of Earth so that it'll work off a flat plane called the equatorial plane that dissects a model of Earth at the vernal equinox. So you don't have the horrible issue of tilt and that. But it's working in the center on a plane, an extended infinite plane called the equatorial plane, with the globe just wrapped around it and surplus to requirements. But you can project those angles that are measured on the surface out from the hell point that you've put them in to say that they're working on a curved surface that's actually the protractor you initially measured with. P's an old friend. For those of you who don't know who he is, P's helped me set up this show in some small way. He's also a complete dick. But there we go. That's.
I've heard of him from you, sharing what you just shared before.
If it wasn't for P, I wouldn't have a show. I had to go to him and say, how do I do this? How do I set out a hangout? How do I control it? And he was on the opposing side, and he told me and took the time and held me by the hand and showed me how to do it, even though he actually opposed my position then and now.
It was OBS, wasn't it?
It was OBS. You're right. I got it wrong. It wasn't Hangouts. It was OBS, and he knew how to do it, and I didn't know who to ask. He's the only one who used to show himself doing it and had the OBS on screen. I was like, please, can you show me how to do this? He went, yeah, all right. Totally good graces. Didn't make a fuss. Took as much time as it needed to explain how to do it to me.
So we thank should you. All say thank you to Pete.
He also got his arse out on one of my live streams and almost got me banned. So, you know, there's swings and roundabouts.
You didn't get almost banned for that.
Not allowed nudity. It's part of the terms of service.
It's not, no, the butt. I don't think the butt counts.
What, a naked butt isn't nudity. Yeah, whatever, P. Just let's not justify your actions.
What, was he trying to prove a moon?
Yes, he was.
At least, like, in America, freedom of speech protects us showing our butts to each other. So, I don't know, maybe in the UK it's different, but.
No, you're confusing, like, constitutions and laws of the land and bills with terms of service for a private entity called YouTube. They can make whatever rules they like. What you did was within their rules.
YouTube has videos of, like, people getting, they're having, what is it?
Don't say what you're about to say. I'm still recording. I don't want this getting demonetized, please. Let's just keep it on flat Earth.
All right.
Thank you.
Well, he did say he was a Christian, so I want him to reconcile the globe in the Bible.
What do you mean? The Bible doesn't say the Earth is flat.
Doesn't say that the Earth is a globe.
It's not a science book. It's a book about God.
Who cares? It's measured flat. Who cares what it says in the Bible?
Well, sometimes certain things happen where they stop the sun from moving in the sky, so that'll destroy the heliocentric paradigm.
Isn't science cause and effect?
Yes.
Okay, so if the Bible claims that God is the fundamental cause of all subsequent chain causation, then wouldn't that be a definitive scientific claim?
Well, no. What you're saying is you could put the context of God into the scientific method, but you'd have God as the independent variable.
Why not?
Well, because you can't vary God. God is the causal influencer. In that example, you've got God as the causal influencer, haven't you? Which is fine, and I don't disagree in the slightest, but I just wouldn't reach it by saying you could formulate it into a hypothesis. What, if not God, then, you know, it's a, you can't vary it.
there'd be a philosophical argument that like God would be necessary for the causal principle to make sense, or like the laws of logic, or uniformity of nature. So science actually does rely on the existence of Christianity to be true for science to make sense.
No, it doesn't. Science is a method. No, it doesn't. Science is a method.
Yeah, but science is based on foundations which science can't prove, and only God can make sense of the foundations of science.
What are the foundations?
Like the uniformity of nature.
Tell us what they are.
Like the uniformity of nature, or like the laws of logic.
You're thinking of laws of nature, right? Not science.
No.
What is science then, P?
What is it? Yeah. Like the study of the natural world?
Yeah, what is it?
The study of the natural world?
Yeah, what is involved in that? What's the process?
I don't know what you're asking.
I'm asking you to detail what the study of the natural world, like you just defined it as, is. What is that process?
Scientific method.
It's physics. Physics is the study of the physical. What P is saying is, this is science. And so far, he's done really well. He said, what is physics? That's science. Well, the study of the physical. But more specifically, the physical and natural world. That is physics. Yeah? Or, otherwise known as, science. So what is that study of the physical natural world? What is involved in the process?
Well, like the scientific method? Is that what you're getting at?
Yeah, there you go. What is the scientific method?
Theoc, problem, hypothesis, observation, conclusion.
No.
I was right?
You're close. Not quite right. But we're asking Pete.
Kinky. Thank you.
We're asking P, but you were close enough.
Thank you.
Observation of what?
Well, what are you guys watching?
Say again?
Oh, I thought you were streaming or something. Never mind.
No, my stream ended. Okay, well, just for P's benefit. Step one, observe natural phenomena. Step two, formulate a hypothesis with a presumed cause of the phenomena and a null that says if you vary your cause, it won't cause the phenomena. Then you experiment, which is variation of your presumed cause, to see if it causes the phenomena or not. If it does, you validate that hypothesis. If it doesn't, you validate your null. Empirical outcome is the end result. It either proves your supposition true or does not prove your supposition true, which affirms the negative or zero difference result. You prove the zero difference result. So proof is the only outcome. It's an empirical method to study the physical and natural world. There you go.
Okay. So that being said, if somebody said, does the Bible say that the Earth is flat or a globe? And you respond, it's not a science book. Are you even responding in the relevant category to the question at all?
No.
Yeah, because that would be like a scientific question, so you would find that answer in a science
book. Okay, hold on, friend. Yep, hold on, that's great. So, according to what Nathan just read, please show how the shape of an object fits in that process.
I don't think it does.
You're correct. Therefore, it's not a scientific proposition in itself. And therefore, the Bible being a science book or not being a science book is irrelevant.
Well, it'd be in the category of like the natural world, right? Like the what shape the Earth is. So that would be the category of science to answer that. It wouldn't be like the Bible is about God, and so it answers questions about God. It doesn't answer questions.
You're suggesting shapes are science. That's what you're saying. Shapes aren't science. That's maths.
Okay.
But to answer you, it's a category.
Let me ask it this way. This is a test question. Which one of these are shapes? Circle, kumquat, if heat, then water boils. Which one?
Well, like, shapes don't actually exist. Like, a circle would be, like, a mathematical object, right? So science wouldn't, like, study mathematical objects. But, like, the Earth exists. And so science would deal with questions about, like, the Earth.
No.
Including its shape.
No, no. Yeah. Step one, observe natural phenomena.
Yeah, the Earth would be an observed natural phenomenon.
What's happening? Concrete noun.
Yeah, I thought that too, remember? There's stuff happening on Earth.
I do remember you thinking that. I do remember you thinking that. I am clairvoyant.
I used to think the same thing. Right. So I was educated.
I'm clairvoyant too. I do tarot.
I'm gonna run.
Breaking up AI.
So I'm currently in my vehicle.
Okay.
And I need to go somewhere. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rect.
You need to drop and rejoin.
Yeah, he said he's in his car. We just have to bear with him.
Oh, are we going to over how and why is not what is? Is that what we're going to go over?
Yeah, basically.
Yep.
That's okay.
Measurement is of what is. How and why use it is. You use the scientific method. They're just different standards. It's really easy. I don't know why people are having a hard time with it.
Because well, how it was explained to me was there's things happening on Earth, and those there's natural phenomena going on the Earth, but Earth itself is just a noun.
Yeah. Not something occurring.
Right, like the leaf I'm just watching right now fall off the tree.
Yeah, that's a phenomena. You can put that through the scientific method, but Earth, no, you can't. It's a category error. It's been you deal with it with maths and measurements.
Yeah, and it's measured flat.
Precisely.
Game over.
Yeah. Well, no. I mean, you can have 19 attempts with someone telling you that a curved surface can meet a 90-degree point on the ground, and, you know, you pointing out that's absolute garbage and nonsense, they won't listen to. So, therefore, in their mind, the debate continues, because they don't want to hear it.
What I didn't understand about that was he went through the process himself and proved Earth was flat.
First guy?
These people are in a psychological dilemma. You know, they're in a psychological dilemma. They've got the evidence. You know what we're...
You're breaking up two on deck. Go on, John.
I was... Like, the whole thing is, right, to say level is not horizontal. Like, you hear that, and there's something in your mind that's like, but it looks horizontal, you know? And then they tell you about it's so big it's flat. And then they point you to Earth curve maths as a way to prove that level is not horizontal. And it's using level as a horizontal plane to derive the differential between eye level and surface level to prove that surface level is curving. No. No, that doesn't make sense.
Oh, boy.
Hey-ho. Anyway, the debate continues because people don't want to hear that their globe has come from flat Earth measurements, which is a shame. But there we go. That's how it is.
What stuck out to me was, I want to change the subject. You've said it 3 times. Please stop. It's hurting.
Well, it's in the transposition from level to horizontal. in that misconception is where the globe is built, right? Because level is your first person experience of horizontal, right? And horizontal is like a third person view. It's when you take yourself completely into the objective and stick purely to geometry. So it's not an easy thing. And then you have the celestial sphere and dip correction calculations that say only work with the geometric horizon, but use a surface level as a horizontal plane. It can't be easy to comprehend these points when they're brought up to you, and the consequences of what that means about NASA, about their education system, it's disturbing.
Well, I want to ask you, you think that guy was genuine?
So what happens when you
he
have
couldn't comprehend gas pressure?
Scrap it.
Because I don't think he was being genuine. Sorry, go ahead.
Yes, because he's saying if
he's got a broken signal, so he's receiving a broken as well. So when he's just talking, I think he thinks he's talking in a gap like Neil typically does. But he doesn't. I don't think he's intentionally trying to talk through you, John. He's just hearing a broken received signal as well, if that makes sense. AI, go ahead.
Oh, fair enough, but that time I was intentionally interrupting.
I doubt that you're saying that just to antagonize. Go ahead. AI, go ahead.
I was saying, well, what happens when they have a discrepancy between... What happens when they have a discrepancy between their assumption of vertical and the actual measurements that they take in the real world? What do they have to do?
Bend horizontal.
If they have a problem like that.
They bend horizontal, that's what they do. Not the globe.
Oh, I gotta quit.
Not the
globe.
Why
are we having audio issues? Maybe we are.
We are. They have to bend horizontal when that happens. The globe model doesn't, but they as a fundy anti-flat earth.
That's
go ahead, John. I think AI is dropping and rejoining, perhaps.
Yeah, but what they do is, you know, level is horizontal. They'll say, no, it's not. And then they'll use level as horizontal to claim that level's not horizontal. But it's an absurdity. But it's, I think, mainly confusing between how we see and what we see. Just like when we talk about the angle to the star and they want to talk about the height of the star, it's a confusion.
Yeah, that's where that guy went. He was trying to go to Polaris, being so far away, but Nathan didn't let him.
I mean, what a lot of them have started saying... What a lot of them are saying now is like,
on one of you.
I was asking that question to Fish for the answer. The correct answer is that they curve the plumb line. Now, how it effectuates itself in the average globe zealot is different in their mental model of the world they live in. But in the geodesy, they curve the plumb line multiple times. Based on the a priori adherence that they have to preserve the angles at their location assumed to the celestial bodies, right? So they assume axiomatically a relationship between the celestials and the ground, and then they transform the plumb line to it So it's not simply the case that they're going out and allegedly measuring the Earth as a globe. Okay, it's in the literature that they apply a bunch of transforms that have fundamental assumptions. And so they have to shove their field data through a cheese grater. And then the cheese that comes out the other side, they can then sculpt into a model of a little ball.
Yeah. The starting point of what you've described as a cheese being grated up is the cheese itself, which is the measurement of a flat plane to get an angle. They then plonk that angle on a presupposed spherical dingleberry dangling beneath what they call a tangent plane. But it doesn't functionally operate. So they have to then justify moving that angle to the center of hell. By justification with parallel light rays moving to the center of hell, ergo it doesn't make any difference because the lights are so far away. At that point, you can then start matching up your points with angle measurements off the equatorial plane and describing things like PZX triangles out on the globe surface. From PZX triangles out on the globe surface, you can imply, which is where you started, reciprocating zenith angles, which is what you're calling curved plumb lines. Yes, correct. Absolutely spot on. But that I just described the grating of the cheese, metaphorically.
That's the first step. Reciprocal zenith angles couldn't be a curved plumb line because they're reciprocal angles, right? And angles aren't curved, right? So when they take a reciprocal zenith angle, they're actually disproving their own model, because in the model, the plumb lines aren't reciprocal angles.
Right.
Okay, they're all wonkily donkily. Right? Let me post an image here.
No, you're correct. I missed out. Okay, so for example, I missed out have a sign conversion.
We hear it all the time. Go on. That if bridge towers, you know, were built, they need to account for the curve of the Earth, so they have to be.
It's too certain. Difficult. It's your line's so yeah. Crappy. AI. It's a complete train wreck. We can't hear 50% of what you're saying. So, yeah, it's bad enough when it's 70%, but we can't really understand what you're saying either.
Now we're having a delay, gaps. Bro. So I don't know.
Just give up, because you're not communicating your point, not through any fault of your own. Right. Okay, at this point, I'm going to bid the politics server farewell and perhaps move us into the Flat Earth Debate Discord server. So, thank you very much to all of the moderators and indeed the participants who took part in the live show. As much as some of you might get on earful, I'm very grateful for your participation. So thank you very much for doing that. And obviously, once again, thank you to the mods. We typically come on a Friday if you wanted to take part again. I'll be here next week, same time. Does anyone from G Plus want to say anything to Politics Server before we bid them farewell properly?
Yeah, I do. If someone wants to accept something's a natural law and then say the word unless, don't let them keep talking. At that point, they're just trying to give you their religious belief.
Yeah, or insert if. Righto, thank you, ladies and gentlemen of the Politics Discord server. We will see you next week. Thanks again to the moderators. You did an outstanding job. Right, I'm going to jump into Flat Earth Debate on the Ever After show. Should have really said that before I left. Hey ho. I'm sure people will see me in there and join. Hey Eli, didn't actually get a chance to say hello to you.
Hey, what's up, y'all? How's today's show go?
Alright, I guess. It was alright. Standard fare.
You don't want to go on Earth Awakenings just to see how night and day it is?
See what?
Into awakenings to see like how night and day it is.
No, we've already done that, been there, and throwing pearls to swine is not my idea of fun.
It is good here in the fight, though. You know, there's nothing like some FED debating.
Oh, good to hear it. They're saying even though it's standard fare, the responses and rebuttals from them and the overcomes being rumpus and all the rest of it, all standard, but still good fun.
I mean, it's either they're getting weaker, or we're getting stronger, one of them or the other.
Bit of both. The more time progresses, the less stressed I am about having debates about the subject. There's nothing that's going to particularly phase me as far as I can see. I would have come across it already. Go on, Eli.
Sorry. Not on mute.
I mean, I'm just saying it's standard. They're stuck. They're all stuck. They're all armed with their particular, angles at it. You know, they're all like, this guy's on different pressures, and this guy's on, you know, plums, and this guy, you know, but they're not saying anything we haven't come across before, and it shows every time they say it again, because they don't change their tune. And neither do we, but we will, I don't know, like I will, if I have something to add to it, I'll add to it. But these are pretty solid arguments.
I was pretty clever when that guy,
I didn't get that.
And the live show is really heated, and the after show was really painful. Thanks mostly to AI, I'm going to say.
That's a good way to describe the after show. But that gas pressure thing, man, that was frustrating me a little bit. Because I think they were playing games. They know exactly what you were talking about. Well, what are you saying? What are you saying? You don't damn well what we're saying. You have a vacuum above us.
The first guy was genuine, I believe. The guy that wasn't understanding the second law the whole time, right? Because I asked him later in the text chat.
Guy that came in. Okay. It was another guy that came in.
Oh, yeah. The rest were just trolls, man, and zealots. Hurt zealots. But how about talking causes gravity, guys? Did anybody ever hear that before? Like, that was a new one for me. Talking causes gravity. All
yes.
Right.
Right? That was funny.
Just when you think you heard everything, there it goes.
That I just googled gravity, and there's only one gravity, Mighty Mush, because I just googled it.
Hey, can you guys hear me?
Yeah, yes. I heard you when you first started, and then you stopped.
Yeah, you're good.
I was just saying, the guy agreed with me detailing the dip angle, it being parallel planes. He agreed with all of that, that level was horizontal, and that, and then when I tried to take him back to what that meant, that's where he disagreed. So level's a horizontal plane unless you're talking about this subject, and then you, it's just not anymore.
Yeah, because he has to relinquish his globe then.
Daz is a one-trick pony. In fact, he holds on to his vertical being the only thing necessary to do celestial navigation until you ask him, well, if you don't have a plumb bob, how do you establish a vertical? And then, of course, you have to use a horizontal. So it's silly.
Yeah, plumb bobs in space. The funny thing is, Del thinks you could do that too. Del thinks all you need is a plumb bob.
That's a good title to a video.
Plumb bobs in space?
Well, the thing is, if you're operating in free space, right, you're just purely in the conceptual, there is no up and down, left or right, vertical or horizontal. There's only perpendicular, parallel, or some phase between those, some angle related to a point. There, you need Earth. You need to be on Earth or in reality somewhere above Earth to describe these things. It's weird.
Correct. Hey, Eli, let me ask you this question. What is it that, because it happened to me when my brother first started telling me about it and when he was actually taking space away, what is it that makes people fight? Like, I remember for a few weeks, oh, man, I was so annoyed at my brother, pissed to the point where I wanted to strangle him. And that's what you get when you start breaking down that space could be fake. Like, venom comes out of people.
It's religion.
Yep.
Everybody gets mad when you talk about their religion. Or not even talk about, well, yeah, people do talk about it, but say a person like myself or like Nathan, or like most of us, we'll just ask clarifying questions about it. You know, and that's a problem. So it's like when you say, well, okay, this is what's defined in your religion. Can you explain this? And that makes people upset.
Yeah, it happened too. To AJ and Vlad right at the beginning of this recording. So Vlad and AJ are taking the first guy we spoke to through the process of gas pressure without a container, because they kind of stepped in on a debate where the guy's debating another flatty about fakery and footage from NASA. And he got upset as soon as it was taken away from the neutral outcome discussion of fakery and pictures that he could easily rebut or offer some semblance of a rebuttal that kept him safe in his belief of a globe in a sky vacuum. As soon as AJ comes along, backed up by Vlad, you've got a lot of obfuscation and irritation because there's nothing they can do in the face of that.
Yeah, but hats off to those people that indoctrinated everybody, because they did it in a way where people will fight for that religion.
Just because they're born into it. It's the same if you were born into Scientology or any cult or any religion. If you're born into it, you've got a balls to bones understanding that that is the case. It's not a belief to you. So when someone comes along and challenges it, it's going to annoy you because it's challenging your belief. Got to figure a way of more softly phrasing their globe requirement for a flat plane measurement, like I did with P Mars. lay it out for them. No, no, you're fine. You're a globe believer. Did you know your globe came from flat earth measurements? And this is how. Because that is the tact, I feel, that's going to be most successful moving forward with globe believers. Forget about our general front foot forward attitude with flat earthers for a second. And just in the general debate, why not lead with your globe is based on flat earth measurements?
Because
yeah,
flat earth is a trigger word, or always will be. It really bothers them.
Yeah, I bet. I'm not doing it for their comfort. It's not so I can counsel them.
Mic check?
Yeah, is that you just said that, didn't you say so?
I was just saying that flat earth is a trigger word, and I don't think it's ever going to be softened for any of these people.
Maybe not. I had to pull out all the stops today to get them riled up enough to interject, you know, intellectual superiority and calling them stupid and all that. Labouring the examples of where their predecessor had made themselves look stupid by example. That was enough to trigger them. And it's because we figured out quite a long time ago that the real problem where Eli answered is challenging their religion, it's pride. That's the real problem, isn't it? If you can just appeal to it without even having the argument in place, you know, you guys are just stupid. You've demonstrated your ignorance with this example. That will hopefully be enough. And it was in that example on politics server to get them all engaged, right? They all piped up the minute they think that they're being demeaned. Crappy little piece of psychology, but worked. Go ahead, whoever that was.
It's exposing. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
It's exposing. I was just saying they were ruffled. Go ahead now, man.
All right. So it exposes their insecurity about their faith, their religion. So as a Bible believer, if you're not confident in what it is that you know, or if your faith is weak, then things like evolution, heliocentrism, the Big Bang causes a reaction in people, in believers, and I can speak from experience, that, you know, just kind of boils over into emotion and craziness and fallacious rhetoric. So their insecurity is being exposed because they rail against it so hard.
It's 2 days in a row we're having a really slow wind down to the live show. I mean, not that I mind. I mean, that's kind of what this after show's for. If it ends up being prolonged silences, that's just the way it goes.
Yeah, but why you make such a quick exit?
I just feeling like I interrupt people.
I made a quick exit because they asked me specifically not to hang around for hours on end. So at the 3 hour mark, I ducked out.
Was it the 3 hour mark already?
Yep.
Oh.
I'm going to round out. With that, I'm going to say a huge, massive, enormous thank you to both Discord Politics and Discord Flat Earth Debate servers for making today's after show and live show possible. And of course, another massive thank you to my G+ panel and to all of you for liking, commenting, sharing, subscribing, joining as a Nathan Oakley 1980 channel member and all that good stuff. I've been Nathan Oakley and I will see you all in the next video.
What a lovely day.